Dimitri, how are you doing? Good to see you. I have a fan club over here. Thank you. Great. So thanks to all of you for coming. I really appreciate it. And if you're here, oh, you're late. You fail. Fail. No, come. I'm just kidding. I'm not kicking you out. I'm just messing. Are there any seats somewhere? There's one seat if you want it. Any other seats? There's one here. Any other ones? So if you want a couple seats, there's some mixed in. So thanks for coming on a Saturday morning. So by being here, you're already doing a fantastic job of leading yourselves by getting out of bed. I didn't want to get out of bed this morning, actually. I woke up at 6 and went to the gym, breakfast and all that stuff. I didn't want to do any of it, but I did it anyway because that's kind of part of it. So this talk doesn't really have a title. I think, Kaishan, what do we call the meetup? Like, it was how to win at something. I don't remember, right?
How to win and lead at data.
Yeah, because we're all here to win, right? We're here to win. So that's kind of the idea. And the reason is that when I talk with people over the years, sometimes people want to talk about technical things. But when I do mentoring, probably 80%+ of the time is spent on things like, how do I negotiate my salary? Or how can I get a better job in data science? Or how can I become a manager? Or something to this effect. So there seems to be some underserved need for talking about these kind of soft skill topics. It's really, really common. I don't know, does anyone here, who here has like a manager or a leader or a boss or something? Probably everybody, right? Most of you? Somebody? None of you? I'm serious. I really need to know this because it will help me structure the talk. So who here works somewhere where you have a boss? Yeah, you have a boss somewhere. Dimitri has no boss because he's king of the world. Okay, cool. Everybody's got a boss. I got one too, I'm sure. Kind of. Well, that's me, but same principle. So I'm sure that when you have those discussions with your boss, hopefully those kind of topics are coming up. So do you talk with them about that? Do you ever ask them questions about how you can? No? Nothing? You do? So Eugene's winning. Anyone else winning? Not really. Kind of, sort of. Okay. But it's a big topic. And if you're not talking with your boss about it, probably you're thinking about it and you're probably wondering about it, and that's why you're here anyway. So some background before we get into it. If you're on Twitter, you can find me there. If you think what I'm saying is awesome, AA Drake hashtag leader. If you think it's just a bunch of crap, AA Drake thought leader. No one will know the difference but us. So it's a nice little voting mechanism. And this is not my idea, by the way. I took this from Josh Wills. Oh, you can come in. Come on. Join the party. Yeah. Are there more out there?
Yeah.
Get them in. Really?
Are there more people?
Yeah.
Not yet. Okay, cool.
So if you agree with the stuff, hashtag leader. If you don't agree with the stuff, hashtag thought leader. That's a little voting mechanism if you want it. So background on me. That's kind of me. I've been into technology stuff for a long, long time. I liked math when I was a kid. I liked computers when I was a kid. I liked computers before I actually ever had a computer or saw a computer. I don't know how that's possible, but I actually have proof of this somewhere. When I was a little kid making stuff in kindergarten. So I've been into this stuff for a long time. And when I was earlier in my career, I used to think that tools could solve a lot of things. And I would try to solve problems with tools. And after a while, I realized that tools are kind of off to the side. The biggest difficulty that I faced over the years are actually people-related problems. How to solve problems between people, how to get people to use the tools that I think are good, how to get people to solve problems in a way that makes sense, aligning people's priorities and incentives, because if you have two people that want different things, they're just going to fight, they're not going to work together. These are like the actual hard problems of making progress. So it's not really about the technology, but that's how I got started. So that's kind of my background and my perspective. How many of you are currently in technology-related roles, where you either write code or do something with IT infrastructure or something sort of like that? Most. How many are in kind of management or maybe product management or some other kind of role where you're dealing with a lot of people, project management kind of stuff, these kind of things, but you're not really doing technical stuff? Most of the rest. Okay.
Both.
Sorry?
Both.
How many of you are doing
both? Is it mutually exclusive?
Sometimes. Some product managers really don't want to write code. But some people who do coding stuff end up having to also do project management or product management. It does happen. So that's kind of the perspective that I have on this. And over the years, I sort of came to this conclusion that it's more about people and leadership than it is about technology and tools. Even though I still do tech stuff, some of you maybe were at the talk I gave, I don't remember, a month ago or 2 months ago. So I still write code all the time because I like to and it's fun. But that's not what I do for companies when I advise them. And I do advise quite a lot of companies around the area, and usually this is the issue. So I talk to them for a while, and then I say, well, it's a leadership problem. It's almost always true, because the people are usually smart. The tools are usually fine. But it's usually an issue of the company priorities are not clear. People don't know what they're supposed to do, or maybe they don't agree with what they've been told to do. Maybe they haven't been motivated to do something. Maybe they were just told to do something, which is not a good idea.
Are you sure they are really smart, or they look smart?
Most people are smart. That's an important axiom. If you don't accept that axiom, that most people are smart in the sense that they either know what they're doing or can figure out what to do pretty quickly with your help, if you don't accept that part, then might have some tough time doing leadership stuff. Might have some tough time. We'll get to why later. So this is what I see most of the time. I usually never go into a company and say, oh, well, your database is just wrong. If you just fixed your database, then you would make $1 billion and your product would be fantastic and you would have all the users and then whatever, you'd be bigger than Facebook or something like this. That never happens. It never happens. So it's not a technology or a tools thing. It's actually a people thing and leadership thing. But we didn't actually talk about what leadership is yet. And that's kind of important. Because if we're going to talk about it, we probably ought to define it. Otherwise, we're just sort of wasting time. So I have a mathematics background, and the first thing we do in math is we always define things. So I typically start with that. So leadership is getting people to want to do what you want them to do. That's one definition. It's one commonly accepted definition. There's a slight twist on this. Some people use it says leadership is getting people to do what you want them to do. That's not the same. That is definitely not the same. There are a lot of ways to get people to do what you want them to do, and most of those ways are not sustainable and they're not a good idea, and oftentimes they're not very nice. But if you get people to want to do what you want them to do, that's actually a pretty good arrangement for everybody. So this is kind of the definition I'm going to go with today. The trick is, how do you get someone to want to do what you want them to do? The hard, abrasive truth is you manipulate them. And I say it like that on purpose. I say it like that on purpose. Because when people say manipulation, usually it has a really bad connotation, right? Like you're trying to take advantage of someone or make the situation bad or better for yourself and bad for them or something like this, right? You're manipulating the situation. But if you want to motivate someone, regardless of your specific job, if you're a leader in a company, if you're a coach for an athletic team, if you're like whatever, if anyone has a personal trainer at the gym, right? They're trying to motivate you, which means they're manipulating you into wanting to do something until you've actually done it enough times that then you want to do it as a habit and you become better for it. So the idea is if you want to lead people, you have to get them to want to do what you want them to do. That's kind of the overall framework. And you have to do this in a positive way, because you believe in them, because you want to take care of them, because you think they have potential, and you want to help them find that potential. Which gets back to our axiom. Is everyone smart? That was your question, sir, gentlemen. That was your question, right? Is everyone smart, or do they just look smart? If you're just looking at everyone saying, oh, you just look smart, but you're not smart, you're going to have a hard time with this one. Because you're really going to have a tough time getting people to want to be more than they are. Because they're not going to believe it. So, yes, I think everyone is pretty smart. So it's kind of a big deal, actually. Because when this fails, yes?
So how do you distinguish somebody who is smart versus somebody who is arrogant?
I smart people are usually more humble. So it's usually not a problem. So arrogant, what I'm sure it is sometimes, but in my experience, usually people who are genuinely smart kind of question themselves a little bit. So they're not so arrogant. And you can raise the Dunning-Kruger effect flag or whatever you want to do, but it just in my experience, people who are really smart also are kind of critical about things, including themselves. So it's usually not an issue. And arrogance is something that we'll get to in a minute, but that's an important topic. So if the leadership fails, then everything fails. So without raising your hands, because I know some people might be embarrassed about this, but I would imagine a lot of you are kind of unhappy with either your boss or your boss's boss or something like this, because they don't help you, they don't grow you, the leadership's not great, it's confusing, they manage you too much, they manage you too little, something like this. It's very, very common, and it's most of the reason why companies have trouble. It's most of the reason why companies have trouble. So when I'm advising companies, 90% of the time, it's something about leadership or operations that's causing their problem. Very, very rarely is it something that's technical. And even if there is some technical problem, that's not causing the whole company to kind of crash and stop. It may be an issue with one part of one product or something like that, but it's not something that just spans the entire company. So it's a big deal. So the main thing that I wanted to get into today, that I wanted to start with, is I saw some questions. You posted a form where people could post some questions, right? So some of you, maybe, or some people who are not here, I don't know, some mix, submitted some questions. And a lot of the questions were, what can I do to become a leader? How can I get a promotion? What do leadership roles in data science look like? These kind of things. And the first answer to that is, if you're going to lead other people, you kind of can't do that effectively until you can lead yourself effectively.
You get like people at the entrance, sort of like, you want to come in a bit?
Come to here, yeah. Back seat.
You can move around, you don't have to.
Yeah, there are some chairs here as well.
You don't have to hide. You don't have to hide. Oh, okay.
Yeah, there are some chairs here as well.
You want some chairs? Everybody comfortable? Cool. So before you can lead other people, you have to lead yourself. And if you can't lead yourself effectively, no one's going to follow you. That's just kind of the way it goes. You have to lead by example when you are a leader. So if you can't even take care of your own affairs, then you're not going to be able to help other people take care of theirs. That's just a fact. So before you start thinking about, what can I do to get a leadership position in my company? What can I do to get a better job or a better title or something like this? The first question is, are you actually leading yourself effectively? And the answer should be, not really. I think of this all the time. So I'm constantly working on leading myself more effectively, all the time. What can I do to improve? What can I do to be better? Do I need to get up earlier? Do I need to stay up later? Do I need to work harder or smarter? Do I need to work on this myself, or do I need to delegate it or outsource it? You know, all these different things. I'm doing this for myself all the time. And if you don't start there, why would anyone follow you in the first place? So step one, kind of look in the mirror a little bit before you think of what you should do. Now then, once I tell people that, they say, well, I don't feel confident to be a leader. Actually, I don't quite know what I'm doing. I don't feel confident about this. How can I build confidence? Which is an interesting question. It really is. And the answer is you don't really need to. You can just kind of fake it till you make it. And it sounds kind of stupid, but it's true. It really is. So as an example, what's the difference between someone who's brave and someone who pretends to be brave? Is there any difference? There's no difference.
Aventuring.
What? Sorry?
Aventuring is the difference. Alan Turing is the difference.
Yeah, the Turing test, that's what you're looking at. If you behave like something, you are that thing in the end. Who else can, you know, what else can you say?
Right. So what's the difference? There's no difference.
But back to this thing, you might look smart, but you're not really smart. Mm-hmm. So you do stupid things.
Mm-hmm. You might look smart, but you're not smart.
Yeah.
So you're saying you pretend to be smart?
Yeah, a lot of people pretend to be smart.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, and in the end, they do stupid things. Then
okay.
It reveals that they are not smart.
I think we're seeing a pattern here. I think this is a pattern, for sure. Definitely. Okay. So some people pretend to be smart, but they're not that smart. How long does it take for everyone else to figure that out?
Actually, you just need to 5 minutes. You can see a person.
5 minutes? Wow. Really? I can't figure it out that fast. We should hang out more. I can learn a lot from you. Okay. But in all seriousness, there's no difference between a brave person and someone who pretends to be a brave person. It's the same thing. So when the topic of being more effective as a leader, even though no one reports to you, because just to reiterate and say again, like, leadership doesn't mean people report to you. I probably should have said that in the beginning. So if anyone thought that you're not a leader if people don't report to you, no, it's not like that at all. So leadership is influence. That's all it is. Leadership is influence. And how you influence people has very little to do with whether or not they actually report to you. And the higher you go on a leadership hierarchy in an organization, oftentimes the fewer people report directly to you. And you have to do more work influencing other areas of the organization. So it's a good idea to start with that in mind. Leadership is influence. It's not who reports to you. It's not how many report to you. It's not it at all. So if you're wondering how to start being a leader, you can fake it till you make it. Try to do a good job. Start with yourself first. And then by being able to lead yourself more effectively, you'll project that out to others. But how do you kind of do that in practice? So a lot of people just think that they're going to be like a manager or a boss. And I hear this a lot in Singapore. I want to be a manager. No. I don't want to be a manager. That's not what I like to do. I'm not a fan of management stuff. I'll do it because it needs to be done, but it's not my strong area. It's not what I enjoy doing. I don't like doing budgets. I don't like doing project plans and headcount estimations. And I don't like doing all that kind of management stuff. I like doing more of the people stuff. More effective, I found. What I see in Singapore a lot is people say they want to be a manager. And I say, why do you want to be a manager? And I say, well, then I can sit in my office and tell people what to do. I've literally had people tell me that. I'm not making it up. I'm not exaggerating. They've literally said that. I can sit in my office and tell people what to do, and I can sit at my computer and they can do all the work. That's what they said. So I'm not Singaporean. I haven't been here that long. I don't have an opinion on the matter. That's just what I heard. So it's kind of this approach, like, oh, well, if I'm a leader, then I can tell people what to do. No, because leadership is getting people to want to do what you want them to do. It's not telling them what to do. Those are really different. So you can't go about it this way. You can't just start and say, well, I'm the boss, do what I say. So what do? You need these two qualities. If I had to pick like two qualities for people to work on for leadership, and I work on these every day. Every day I work on these qualities. You have to be humble, have humility. You have to know that you can learn from other people, that other people are smarter than you, that if you're leading other people, they should know more than you about their specific domain. And that shouldn't scare you. If it scares you that people know more than you, you won't give them the freedom to operate. Then you're going to micromanage them, and you're probably going to do a bad job because they know more than you anyway. So I think one of the questions was, what do you do when you know more than your boss about data science stuff, something to that effect? And the answer is, maybe the boss needs a little more humility so that they can have some trust in you and let you run free. So humility is a big one. You got to be able to learn from other people. Doesn't matter where they are, doesn't matter where they come from. I was talking to a company that has an innovation center in Singapore, which is like the cool thing to do now. A lot of these big companies have it. They open innovation centers. Thank you, EDB. It's really appreciated. What, you work at the innovation center somewhere? Which one?
The Densely AGs.
So there are a lot of them, right?
Yeah.
Even we have people in the audience working for them. So I was talking to people at the Innovation Center the other day, and they were actually having kind of a disagreement internally in their center about who can have good ideas. Which is hilarious when you figure they're an innovation center. Like this is and this is what I mean. The leadership thing is real. It's a real thing. Like you're talking to the best of the best people from this big megacorp that has set up this innovation center in Singapore and spent millions of dollars to do it, and they're sitting around arguing over how senior you have to be before your ideas can be good. It's a real thing. And the argument was, can someone who's like a custodian or an assistant or something have a good idea? Obviously, yes. Obviously, yes. I've had, in my personal experience, cases where people from any level of any organization can have a fantastic idea. But if the leaders don't have the humility to be able to accept that maybe their ideas aren't the best, that really slows everything down. Discipline is the other one. You have to be able to do things that you don't want to do, that need to be done, that maybe aren't fun, and you have to be able to do that every day and hold yourself to high standards and all that stuff all the time. And that doesn't mean you need to be strict and angry at people and things like that. No, that's not what it's about. It's about being reliable and responsible. It's about taking ownership of things, even if you don't fully control them. Because that puts you in a mindset where you can try to influence them. And leadership is influence. So, there you go. These are kind of the four main points that I try to get people to work on, and I work with people on these points. So if you're actually in a role right now where people are reporting to you, or if you're just trying to lead yourself, these are kind of the things to focus on. These are the things people need to understand. When I go to a company, I ask these questions to every person that I talk with. And most of the time, nobody knows the answer to these questions. So if you look at, think for yourself, wherever you work, do you know what the goal or the mission is for your company? And I don't mean like the one that HR puts on the job descriptions. I mean like the actual real mission that you have, because those are not always the same, right? Why does it matter? That's the big one. That's why it's in capitals, because it's important. Why does this goal matter? How are you individually contributing to that goal? So there may be some really big, at the executive or the board level, they come up with some goal, right? Hopefully it's a good one. And they tell you why it's important, because they're fantastic leaders and they want you to understand why what you're doing matters. And then as that trickles down through the hierarchy of the organization, the different levels of leadership help you understand why your work that you are doing today influences that goal. And of course, they have to tell you the constraints. Why do the constraints matter? Because if they don't tell you the constraints, they have to tell you what to do. Every single thing. And that's not the idea. You want to tell people where we need to go and why it matters, give them the constraints, and then let them figure out how to do it. That's the balance. That's the balance. So if you don't take anything else away from this, whatever it is, 25-ish minute talk, please remember the last slide, humility, discipline, and these. That's it. If you get those things, you'll be better as a leader than probably 95% of the people that I ever deal with. And you laughed at some of the questions I said that I've been asked before, you'd be surprised at some of the other ones that I didn't mention. So these things are really important. And I never talk with a company, it's super rare, that I talk with a company where everyone gets this. What I do find sometimes is a department, and the department might have a really good leader, and they've crafted out answers to these questions for their people. That happens. That can be a happy department. So you might have a engineering group or data science group or product management group or whatever, and they all know the answers to these questions, but that's only because the head of product or whatever has crafted that. They're completely detached from the rest of the company, but they're having a good time. So they think it's okay.
Adam, what's an example of a good goal? Is it a mission statement or something? What's an example?
Mission statements are tricky. They really are, because they're hit and miss, right? They're really short, and sometimes mission statements get crafted so that people can take them to mean whatever they want them to mean. That's like a political mission statement.
But goals change, right?
Goals change.
from That's every right. project you change. So what is a goal exactly, example?
So some people will talk about SMART goals and all this other stuff. For me, what I've seen work really well in companies, I'll give an example. So I used to do work before in online travel industry some years ago. And there's a company in Indonesia called Traveloka. I don't know if any of you know Traveloka. They have a mission of enabling mobility. That's their mission, enabling mobility. And when I first heard that, I was like, that's kind of broad. I don't know about that. But then after I thought about it for a while, actually it matters quite a lot. There are a lot of things that change once you enable mobility in a society. People can get better medical care, economic opportunities increase, people can spend time with their families. There are all kinds of things and ways in which society benefits when people are more mobile. You can read the literature on this. This is pretty well documented. So after I thought about that, I thought, actually, that's a really good mission. The issue is that even if you have a good mission like that, but you don't explain it to people in the right context, they're not going to get it, right? I didn't get it when I first started. I was like, enabling mobility? Sounds kind of weak sauce. I don't know. But then after I thought about it for a minute, there are actually a lot of important aspects to that. So something like that, where you have a mission that's short, that's compact, that people can keep in their mind all the time. If someone has to go to like a knowledge base or a wiki or something to remember what the mission is, it's a bad mission. That I can tell you for sure. For sure. Which is why these questions are important. The answers to these questions should be short enough that people can keep them in their mind at all times. This is not like where you make a big 5-page document and you put it on your knowledge base. No. Because people are going to make 1,000 little decisions a day, and they should all be guided by the answers to these questions. And it's the same with the mission. Does that help?
So
that's the overview. If you want to start on the path to being more active in leadership capacity, my advice, take it or leave it, start with yourself. Become someone who you would follow as a leader. Take the actions that you need to take to do that. That doesn't mean you have to want to take the actions. That goes back to the discipline, right? If you know you need to do something, you don't have to want to do it in order to do it. I didn't want to get out of bed this morning. Honestly, I really didn't. But I did anyway. Probably a lot of you were like, oh man, I'm tired. It's Saturday. I don't get up. Why am I going to go to SMU at 10 a.m. on a Saturday to go to a data science meetup? Why did I even RSVP for this thing? But you came anyway. That's a good show of discipline. Most of you were on time. Very good show of discipline. Those of you who weren't, you know who you are. I'm not shaming. Thank you. So, do you want to do questions, or do you want to go handle the questions in the panel? Sorry, process or persons?
Persons. Why do you think that good leadership environment starts from good hires?
You need me to move over?
From good hires. Uh-huh. It's important to find proper process with proper values or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
So my question is, do you think that everyone, you can be a good leader with everyone in every environment, or it's important to have a good environment to be a good leader inside?
Okay, so the question is basically, what matters more, the leadership or the team? Is that kind of what you're getting at?
Yeah, let's do it in percentage.
Okay, in percentage.
How it matters to have a good team and good leader inside.
So you had a couple of other points embedded inside your question. So yeah. So I first would like to go to those points, and then we can actually go to the end question. So one of the points, and the one that I think is really relevant, is recruiting. Bringing people into an organization. So that's something that I take really seriously, because people don't need to be the absolute smartest, and they don't need to be the absolute expert in the world, in whatever field it is, but they have to be able to work well with other people. There may have been a time when, and it was true when I got into technology stuff in the 90s, where you could be a tech person and sit at a machine and just code. And that was it. That you didn't have to really talk with anyone. And those times mostly are over. So when it comes to recruiting, you really have to make sure, not so much that people are technical superstars, because if they're pretty smart, because most people are pretty smart, right? Then they can learn. They can learn, right? And I'm sure people in this room have had that situation where they've submitted their CV to some job and they said, oh, well, I mean, we're looking for someone who has experience with Java 8 and you only have experience with Java 7, so clearly we can't hire you, or whatever stupid stuff, right? This happens all the time and it makes no sense, right? So on the technical thing, smart people can, they can figure it out. That's not a big deal. But what takes longer is interpersonal skills. It takes a long time to develop interpersonal skills. And so that's one of the things that I look at when I'm hiring people. Curiosity, discipline, interpersonal skills. Those are the three main things. If they have those, they can learn whatever else, so that doesn't matter. So that kind of touches your recruiting on the inbound side. Now, then the other side of that is, what happens when you end up with someone on your team and they're just not fitting? They don't have the right, I shouldn't say the right mix, and I don't like to use the word culture fit, because that's like a catch-all. But some people are, someone's asking about arrogance earlier, right? There are some people that are more interested in advancing themselves than advancing the team. They're more interested in advancing themselves than the team. That's a problem. So when I go into any conversation, I'm not here to be right. I'm here to win. That's different. It's really, really different. If you go into any interaction to be right, you might have a hard time. You get, and there are people who are like that. They go into these interactions and they say, I want to be right, I want to be the top, I want to be the best. And those people come out really quick, and you have to deal with them really quick. So obviously help them try to adjust their perceptions of themselves and others. Try to work with them. But if they're just not getting it, you have to cut them out fast, because it becomes really toxic to people on the team. So that's kind of the recruiting and the retention part. Now, then the other part, and kind of the meat of the question, was what matters more, the team or the leader, right? I don't know the percentage, so I can't really say. But there are many examples, and I've been part of them, where you can have a great team, and then you swap out the leaders, and then the team starts to degrade. Or, on the other side, you can have a team that's maybe not so great, put in some really good leadership, and the team starts to perform. They start finishing projects, they start shipping stuff, they start taking their work more seriously and taking more pride in it. So what I've found is the best reflection of whether or not a leader is effective is if their team is effective. And I don't mean effective for a little while, I mean on an ongoing basis. So I would say that leadership matters more than the people in the team. And it's been the same for me. If I've been in a team and the leadership is bad, it's hard for us as a team to perform. It's hard for me as a team member to be able to perform, because I may not know exactly what I'm supposed to do. I may not know clearly how all of the people in my team are supposed to interact so that we can make progress, because the leadership is not as effective as it could be. Now, I take responsibility for that, because there were those questions which... let's see. So going back to those questions... So with these questions, these are the things that you should be answering for people as a leader, but they're also things that your leadership should be answering for you. And if these questions aren't answered for you, then you have to take the responsibility and the ownership and figure out what the answers are. And usually you can kind of find a way to meet in the middle. But if the leadership is not that effective, it makes it really hard to perform as a team. I've had that experience myself, where I try and try and try and try, but the leadership's not, it's not really that great. Yeah. So I would say the leadership's more important than the team.
Yeah, your slides are great and very motivating, but it looks to me that you are not talking with one hard part, is the conflict management.
Mm.
Because when you lead yourself, hopefully you don't have that much conflict.
I do.
Okay.
I have conflict with myself all the time.
Does that conflict resolution that you apply to yourself apply to when you are leading a team?
I can't be as strict with other people as I am with myself.
Right, so then
that's the biggest difference that I would say. So with myself, I'm quite strict. So when there are conflicts between people in the team, if I'm leading the team, then I take that as my fault. That's my fault. For what it doesn't matter the specific reason why there's a conflict. It's my fault. I take full responsibility for it. Always. If it was a bad hiring decision, if it's, I don't know, somebody's arguing because of what, it doesn't matter, it's always my fault. So I try to figure out where I made a mistake. Oftentimes it's because I didn't communicate one of these things well enough. Maybe I didn't communicate some constraints or some direction or something like that as effectively as I could have. That's a big one. But for me, the first step in conflict management is taking responsibility for everything and then doing what I can to fix it. Because when you deal with people and there's conflict, people have a hard time separating their emotional reaction from their logical reaction. It's very normal. And so the first thing that you can do to help that is take full responsibility for everything. That changes their emotional reaction from defensive to, well, it's not all your fault. It's not all your fault, right? And it changes the dynamic really a lot. So I don't know if you're talking about conflict that you have with someone else or conflict that you have as a leader with someone on the team or conflict between two team members and you're a leader.
Hopefully it's between two team members, because if you're a good leader, you will have less conflicts with your team members, hopefully. Because the goal is to motivate them and so
yeah,
on. So
yeah.
You know, we're not going to do that by entering into conflict with
them. Yeah, it's usually not a good strategy.
Yeah. So I was more referring to between two team members.
Yeah, so what I do when I'm in that situation, and there's a similar question someone asked about bosses, I think, that were kind of like micromanaging and how do you deal with this, and it's kind of similar because there's always conflict there, right? And what I try to do is to become very useful to that person. I become very useful for them. So first step, accept responsibility for everything. Doesn't matter what it is. One, that changes the perspective of the other person. Because then suddenly they want to say, well, it's not all your fault, it's okay, we can work on this together, and it changes things. The second thing is it changes your mental perspective, and it gets you more focused on the things you can control and that you can influence. So that's what I do. Then the second thing is I try to be useful to people. And that's important because you have to completely set aside your own ego. So if anyone has ever thought, well, I don't know if I want to do this for this person because they always take the credit. Not a great idea. Not a great idea. You're really getting in your own way. Your ego is preventing you from actually delivering something useful. If you're worried about the credit, you're going to have a hard time as a leader. Because the team always gets the credit. The leader gets the blame. That's the rule. Every time. And if you're going to lead people, you have to be willing to accept that. So I usually go for those two things. One, just immediately turn it around and take responsibility for everything. And then that usually helps actually quite a lot. And then the second is to try to help those people look better. And usually that will reverse it. Now, there's always the case of the person who's kind of pathologically arrogant or whatever. They just, no matter what you do, they're always going to be a problem. And that's something you kind of have to talk to your leadership about. And your leadership should notice that pretty quickly and deal with that pretty quickly because it's usually very obvious. It's usually very obvious when a person is just a problem and they're not getting it and they have to go. So unfortunately it does happen sometimes, but it's rare. Did that help?
Okay.
Sort of, yeah.
But what if your leader is arrogant? Like,
sorry, we had to
raise
hand.
Okay, can you contextualize what you say today? Let's say in a software project management role.
Okay.
You know, so you are leader of a software project.
Uh-huh.
You know, what are the tools you have that can help you to improve your leadership? You know, what are the experience you have maybe from a previous experience that you can share with us? You know, exactly what you learned from an experience like that. You know, contextualize, you know, your theory or your perspective today.
So software management and tools, do you mean like specific project management tools?
As if you have a project,
uh-huh.
You know, so you're talking from a project management point of view. A leader as in the project management team. Yeah.
Okay, so the thing I see most common as an issue in that situation is unmanaged expectations. That's it. That's really it. because the business doesn't understand the difference between something that's easy to think about and something that's easy to build. For them, it's the same, right? So if you have a marketing department, let's say, and they want some kind of analytics product, and they just think it up, maybe it takes them 5 minutes to think about it. And so then in their mind, it was easy to think about. Therefore, it must be easy to build, which we all know is totally wrong. It's 100% false. There's not necessarily any link between how intuitive or easy something is to think about and how easy it is to actually build and deploy. So I spend a lot of time on that specific thing, managing expectations and stretching out the timelines so that people understand. What that does is it frees up the team. So then when I go to the team, they have more room to maneuver. They have more freedom to operate, right? So that balance is really important.
Do you have tools or frameworks to improve, let's say, project software development team?
When you say tools or frameworks, do you mean like software tools?
Yeah.
No, that's to me totally irrelevant. I can't say it more plainly than that. Like, you can use a pen and paper and be an awesome leader, or you can use a really fancy project management suite and have a really hard time. Because it's 100% about the relationships and the psychology of the people. The tools are not that big of a deal. I've gone through projects. There was one very nasty one that I worked on some years ago that had been already ongoing for like 5 years. It was supposed to take 6 months. Six. And it was still going 5 years later. And they couldn't stop it because they'd spent so much that if they stopped it, then they would lose all the money, which is, I'm not going to go into that logic. But this was the situation, right? We ran that project with post-it notes on a wall. And we finished it in 9 months. I didn't use any spreadsheet. I didn't use any project management tools. I didn't use anything like that. I use post-its on the wall. That was how we used it. So I'm not, tools, whatever works. It's the same thing with programming languages. I'll use whatever programming language works. There are some I like more than others, but that's not my primary focus. My primary focus is not which one do I like more. My primary focus is which one works the best, because I'm not here to be right, I'm here to win. That's the difference. You know what I mean?
Really like the tool was better, but having said that, you mentioned about tools. So there are a few of them. For example, Office 365. So eventually you are able to see, you really have a dashboard and management or building it, so you know where the time is spent. So how much time you do the meetings, calls, emails, etc. They really have a dashboard to see that. If that's the question, I'm just
imagining. Oh, yeah, you can do that with Jira. I mean, there's all kinds of stuff.
I'm just imagining.
Yeah. Yeah, but the thing is, it's easy to get distracted talking about tools, and tools don't do work. Tools help people do work.
By the way, I really fully agree with you in terms of what it really works for you. You might only have three people, you don't really need anything to have a three guys to sit together and can sync our current.
Well, in that team, it was 75. And it was distributed across different locations. So it's what I found is anytime someone is talking about tools, or if I'm thinking about tools, I always take a step back and I say, okay, am I actually solving the problem here? Or do I just want to feel like I did? And anyone here a Java developer? Okay, I'm only going to partially insult the Java. So the old school Java, not so much in the new days, but like 10 plus years ago, there was this concept that people liked Java because you could feel really productive because you wrote so much code. And there is some truth to it. There is a psychological effect from having written a lot of code, right? And as with Java, the thinking was, well, you kind of get that by nature of using it as a tool, so people like it because they feel productive when they use it. But if they use something like Perl, for example, and we won't get into Perl one-liners, but you can do really short stuff in Perl. So what's the distinction there? And there is an effect of, okay, I'm using this tool, I'm doing this stuff, I've got charts, I've got graphs, I've got metrics, and that's a management thing. That's a project management thing, like you're saying. Like, what are the metrics? How many hours do people spend on whatever it is? How many hours do people spend on meeting? But I would much rather just go to someone and say, do you feel like you're spending too much time on meetings? Like, that will have a totally different psychological effect.
Back to what you mentioned earlier, Java guys, I think they are great, they write a lot of Java coding, etc. It's just because the people realize, once you've done that, you have that fact, and people are come back trying to address that, then they either having the tools or you know going to synchronize to discuss about the solution, effectiveness, etc. Therefore, today you might look back to Java again, you have a lot of Hadoop framework on top of that, or other languages learn from the license, etc. So I think that's not a bad thing. You can start from somewhere, but you need to know the fact how to address that. Because if you don't even record knowing those people are spending, you know, maybe not effective time in something stuff, which is you probably don't even know where you can start, just still all the team are moving very slow. But which exactly the part is slow and not effective. I think that still makes sense to having tools to have the realization. But yeah, that's my point.
No, I'm not saying it's bad to know, but in my experience, there's people say a lot of laws, Conway's law and all this stuff, but there's one that I actually like, which is Goodhart's law, which is once you start measuring something, once a metric becomes a target, it's not a good metric anymore. And so, sorry, please. So when you, if you start having meetings, for example, meeting time as a target, reduce meeting time, I guarantee you your people will reduce meeting time. I 100% guarantee it, but that doesn't mean they'll be more productive.
My point is not actually the meeting or whatever time spent certain activities. It's you don't have awareness where your problem, your holes are there. For example, the company, all the companies spending millions of dollars to do the BI project, to try to figure out, you know, how I'm going to perform my revenue, you know, which product is good, which one's not. They spend so much time just crunching the data, figuring it out, to get the management, made that decision to do the right things. So I'm saying having the right tools actually definitely helps the decision makers, which is proper stuff. That's my point. I'm not saying, oh, the goal is, we see the meeting too much. That's just all going to reduce the meeting.
I think you two agree, because Adam talked about mismatch expectations in the beginning. And, you know, tools can be a way to bring these out in the open and then resolve them.
Yeah.
But it's probably not the only way.
Yeah.
But okay, what's
just a question? You mentioned what the constraint, right? So,
yes.
Usually, is what we face is usually time and budget. So, but what important is the approach? For example, in this case, you all discussed about the tools can find out what's the problem, but the real thing behind is what's the approach. So, can you know what's your approach to get?
So, I don't think that tools necessarily can tell you what the problem is. I think tools often hide the problem. That's why I'm not a big fan of tools.
But how's your approach to deal with your country?
I just ask people. It's really that simple. I mean, this is I can't emphasize this enough. Being a leader is about people, 100%. It's about caring for people, making sure that they can grow, that they feel safe, that they know that you care about them and that you want to develop. That's it. And anything beyond that is an implementation detail, in my opinion. So you might need it for some things, but it's not critical. So when it comes to things like tooling, use what works. If you need some BI tooling to figure out some things, definitely use it. If you need project management tooling because you need to have some kind of reporting for your finance department, that's fine. But that doesn't mean, and I'm sure some of you experienced this, like you get time tracking pushed down your throat because some finance person wants to know how much of your hours they can bill to some other department. And it's so demotivating, right? Because you feel absolutely like some cog in the machine. And they want you to like log all your hours for everything. Like I was in a meeting for 25 minutes and then I was writing code for 35 minutes. And it's crazy, right? And so what I've always tried to do is to separate that. So the team wants to work on work stuff. They don't want to work on logging their hours. So I try to find ways with the finance department, for example, where we can satisfy their accounting requirements without having to make the team do the logging of the hours or something like this.
Yeah, just happened breaking to me. Part. The company invests in SAP just to do that, and we screw them real hard.
Yeah, see? But I'm sure the SAP salespeople made a nice commission on that, so that's great.
Okay,
we'll take one more question before we start the panel because we're going in a bit late. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Your hand was up first, so you can.
I think that the most important tool of the good manager is a one-on-one with the employee.
Yeah.
So not the software tool, but it's like the discussion that you have on a regular basis with your colleagues, with people who we are trying to.
Agreed.
The most important.
Agreed. Last question.
The 4 points of data, the 4 points of slide.
Mm-hmm.
Constraints. Right.
I'd like to hear from your perspective what examples of these constraints mm-hmm. this would help us visualize.
Okay. So, in an ideal situation, there's going to be some big goal, and it's going to and responsibility for different areas of that are going to be split, and then split, and then split, and then split. And so, first you have to know. Let's say you're part of a team, right? As a team, we have some kind of goal that we have to achieve, and we're going to have some kind of boundaries or constraints on the goal. It may be technologies we can use. It could be time that we have. It could be scope. You can't be time and scope bound. That's not allowed. That's contradictory. You can't do that. But there are constraints like this that come up. Now, as a leader, if you're briefing your team on this topic, they need to understand the constraints. This is really important because if they understand your intention, why the thing is important and what your overall goal is, and they understand what the constraints are, they don't have to come back to you all the time to ask questions. That accomplishes two things. One, it frees you up as a leader to be able to keep some of the other stuff away from the team, like the time tracking, right? But also, it gives the team a much bigger sense of autonomy and freedom because it's up to them. How are we going to accomplish this? That's a good question. You're the expert. How would you accomplish it? I mean, if you need something, I can give you advice. I can give you support. If you need more money, if you need more people, I can try to make that happen. But I'm not the expert. Just because I'm the leader doesn't mean I'm the expert. Right? Those aren't necessarily the same thing. So the constraints are all the things your team needs to know so that they can operate semi-autonomously. And it's going to vary from team to team and project to project. But that's the reasoning for having those constraints included. You want to be able to give a brief to the team, say, this is our goal, this is why it matters, this is my intention for when the goal is accomplished, and these are the constraints on accomplishing it. So that's all the where do we want to go and why does it matter, and then all the how do we get there is for the team to figure out on its own.
So it could be physical constraints, like say, time, budget, necessarily, it could be things we have to deal with just to do this.
Yeah. Right. And the trap that a lot of people fall into is they go way overboard on the constraints. They go overboard on the constraints. Too many constraints, most of which are unnecessary. So the important thing with the constraints is that they have to be only the necessary constraints. So that you're maximizing the autonomy of the team. So that's a really important part.
I mean, maybe I can add to that also. There's also business constraints. So take for example, you work at an e-commerce company and you have a lot of new products that are on your platform every day. So maybe one of the business goals is to introduce new products on your search page or on your catalog page. And the business says, okay, help these new sellers generate sales, help them grow. And the constraint is overall conversion doesn't drop by more than 5%, for example. So that's a constraint. Do whatever it takes. But overall constraint doesn't drop, help them. So that's a constraint as well. Simple. There's one single constraint.
Yeah. So I mean, imagine how easy it is if you're in a team and you say something like that. We need to develop a new system to do this and get more sales for the customers. It has to be done in this and this technologies. You have to interface with this and this team. And the constraint is no matter what you do, conversion can't drop by 5%. However you choose to solve it after that is up to you as a team. And that makes it really clear what you're supposed to do and really clear the parameters in which you have to operate. Does that help?
Yes.
Okay.
Cool. Okay, let's go for a 5-minute toilet break and thank Adam for this section. Okay. Let's start with once again, thank you for coming down this early morning. So before we start, maybe everyone knows a lot about Adam, but maybe Pooh can give an introduction about himself.
Woo!
Yeah, okay, hey, hi. Like, hi everyone. Wow, suddenly I've been asked to do my own introduction.
Didn't you ask for this introduction?
Okay. I did. Okay, hi. So I think some of you may have seen me before at the meetups and all this. So I'm actually one of the co-founders together with Kaixing on this meetup group. So thank you very much for the support so far. We really see a lot of people now. The community has been growing. That's not part of my self intro, but. Yeah, so I'm actually in the field for quite a while. I think some of you may have known me, and based on the read-up that you have seen, right, I also do teachings at some of the ISLs over here. But for now, I'm actually freelancing now as a consultant and as a trainer, more of training. My passion, besides helping businesses to learn more about data science and all this, is also helping more people to understand the field, to actually help get more passionate people into the field as well. So that's my self-intro. Yep.
Okay, thank you, Koo. Okay, so we have 25 questions from based on the responses. And I can sort of see that there are two groups of these kind of questions. One kind of question is like, oh, how do I get into data science? So general data science questions. And then the other one is more about leadership in data science or managing leaders in data science. So we'll do both, but I'd just like to get a feel from the audience. Which set of questions are you guys more interested in? General data science, please raise your hand so I can get a vote. And then leadership in data science. I think, okay, it's about the same, but I think general data science sort of ages out a bit.
Can I ask a question? Are we going to open up for audience questions also, or are we just going to run them?
So you can jump in anytime as well. Yeah, is that fine? Yeah, so I guess one question that everyone asks is, how does one who is a mid-career transition into data science?
From?
Technical background, maybe.
What's the assumption of mid-career?
Sorry?
Okay.
What's the defined mid-career from what industry?
Okay, let me read this question. I have some SQL developer skills. What's all this machine learning about, and how can I get into it?
Can I add? Yep. Slightly different. I have an economics background.
Yeah. So, and then. So maybe I'll just add it on. So, how did you pick up your data science skills? Are there daily rituals or habits? So I'm sure Adam has a lot to share about that. What's your advice from someone from another field who wants to transition into data science? Yep.
No, go. Sure. So, as a base question, I get a lot is, do I need to study computer science or math to do data science? And the answer is 100% absolutely not. So I've worked with fantastic data scientists, and my favorite example from a different field was someone who had a PhD in Russian literature, and they weren't Russian. So just to be really clear about that, because they were from the, I think they were from the UK, but they got a PhD in Russian literature and they became data scientists, and they were really awesome. They were really awesome. And the reason was because they understood that they needed a balance of technical skill, communication abilities, business acumen and understanding. It's really quite a wide array of things. The technology is a part of it, and it's maybe the hardest part for a lot of people to pick up, but it's certainly not the case that you should only have studied computer science or math or something. And in fact, for many people, I would say it's easier to pick up the technical skills than it is to pick up the business and the interpersonal skills. So it's case by case, of course, but it's definitely not a requirement.
Cool, you have anything after that?
Okay, I started off as a, I'm an economist by training actually. My first degree is actually econs. What I can share with you is how I actually moved into the field rather. I think that could be something for your reference. I started off as an econ student. I graduated around 2002-2003. Unfortunately, what happened was that during that time, there was a SARS period in Singapore. I could not find any job as an economist. So I had a year blank, sort of like a blank. I can't find a proper job then. But what happened was I stumbled into education research. I did education research. I did for a while and stumbled onto this software called SES. And then some of you, I'm going to stare at this guy using SES. Okay, anyway, so having said that, but then I slowly move on and transition into the field of doing analysis work. From the education research, right, I then move on to actually in the banks as a risk manager, as a risk analyst. I did a lot of modeling, a lot of analysis and all this. So I will see that the whole thing that links up, right, is actually the analysis skill, the technical skills that helps me to actually transition into this particular field altogether. So so I think going back to the question of, let's say if I'm a mid-career, I do see a lot of mid-careers who want to change job into moving into data science or even to data analyst. I feel more importantly is you need to find an anchor point. And from this anchor point, right, you move, you take the next step. You create some small wins for yourself first. Like, hey, yeah, this is something I can do. Or maybe this is something I would like to develop further. And from then you take bigger steps and you also take you also learn more along the way. I think learning, having a strong hunger for knowledge and skills is actually a plus point for all data scientists. Because there's no way we can learn everything. But we want to learn everything. That's the conflict most data scientists would have, actually, I would say. Yeah.
I think Ku's response is great. Let's try to spend a bit more time to try to dissect it. So Ku, if you think about it, he was mid-career in economics himself. Then he moved to risk management. What did you do with, what technical skills did you need to do risk management in a bank?
Okay, I think my econs background actually helped me to transition into the bank. But the second thing was, I have to say, it was learning SAS. Learning SAS actually got me the interview.
So knowing, having the econs background itself is not enough, but knowing that particular tool that the bank used helped you get a foot in the door in the interview.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Just to add something to it, Alan was mentioning that you can have great data scientists, you can do real data science without having a technical background, but in practice, in most companies, what they will interview you on first are technical, very specific technical stuff. You will come with programming interviews and stuff, so you better train that if you actually want to get through the door. So SAS was a way, but most often you can't land a data science job without the technical skills, so they really need to check.
That's if we were to just, because I get this question a lot when I do mentoring. So I also did mentoring like with Data Science Retreat in Berlin, which is kind of a 3-month program where people polish their background so that they can actually be productive data scientists. And the question that comes up a lot is, what do I need to learn to become a data scientist? And you also mentioned people who have kind of a technical background.
Yes.
That want to make the transition. And people who already have some technical capability are at an advantage in the beginning. And the reason is for exactly what we're discussing. When the companies are looking for what to hire, they're going to look for something concrete. So if you have a technical background, it's not so hard for you to do some projects, put them on GitHub or whatever. Now you have a portfolio and people actually can see that you can be productive technologically. And if you're talking about what you need to be productive as a data scientist, you have to be a pretty good software person. You have to be able to write code. Like it's very difficult to be productive in a data science team without being able to write code. So if you haven't gotten to that point yet, then that's where the discipline comes in. You're going to have to be disciplined about it. And that's probably why you asked me about habits, because Eugene knows that I'm big on habits. Just as an example, I like Haskell, which is a functional programming language. I didn't know it years ago. I decided I wanted to learn it. So I started getting up at 5 every morning so I could spend an hour every morning learning Haskell. And that's what I did. And I did it for some months. And then at the end of that, then I was comfortable writing code in Haskell. So it's strictly a discipline thing. And people say, well, I don't have enough time, I'm busy. If something's important, you make time. And there are things that you will choose not to do. It's very rare that I find someone who literally has no time. Most people can get up an hour earlier and they just don't want to. That's a different problem. That's a discipline problem. It's not a time problem.
Can I quickly add someone? Because earlier in the question, someone has a SQL background, how do you do data science? Because I just happened to see a video in the YouTube. You can search, it's called Data Science Superpower. So there is a guy who's really talking about his experience from a SQL person to data science and what the language you need to learn, what exactly the things you need to do. And that's a very good video. I'll definitely suggest you take a look.
Sorry, what's it called?
It's called Data Science Superpower.
Data Science Superpower. Data Science Superpower.
Yeah.
Okay. The cool part is that all this stuff is on the internet, right? So you can pretty much learn everything. Really?
Precisely. I'm just saying this is a very good starting point because he was having a SQL background. All the way talking about the you know, the two different type of person, what the language means to each other, and then he give a real world examples of how he actually be a single person and create a data science project, algorithm, etc., step by step, share the code in GitHub, etc. So that's a very good start for him.
Also, as a point, totally agree with Adam, it's not regarding say what you know, but also regarding what you have done. So I also have some past experience with hire some people doing data science. So what interests me is not say how many whatever calls you have learned. So it doesn't matter too much. It's not regarding what you really have been done. So for example, someone has some research experience in university or research institute. But if you haven't don't have that and you have done something like cargo projects, that you can ask.
Yeah, that's a good point. So if anyone's doing Kaggle stuff, after the competitions are over, I think you're totally fine to release your code, and that doesn't violate any of the terms, if I remember correctly. So if you're doing this kind of stuff, write it up, do a blog post, put the code on GitHub. It really makes a big difference. The challenge I've seen with most people who are trying to get into data science is they don't document and write up their work, and they don't put it out there. And if you're doing that, you're automatically ahead of almost everyone else. Because most people, they'll do a Kaggle competition, and then they'll get sidetracked and do something else. They won't take the time to do that last 5%, write up everything they did, and put it out there. And that really makes a large difference to an employer, because one, they can find it, and they can start to get an impression of your work capabilities. But also, they know that you can communicate effectively, which is really important for people who are getting into data science work. And they know you can finish stuff. Starting things is really easy. Finishing things is hard. And so if you're a person that can finish things, and you can communicate, and you have some technical, then everything else is just a side detail.
Yeah,
the
point?
Yeah. The lady who is in economics, whoever else is in economics, is going to data science. You're closer to data science than you think with all your econometrics classes, your modeling. If you go into one of those Kaggle competitions and you try to apply your models, they will work, and you will... By just reading the forum, learn about new modeling techniques, and then you will be on the technical side quite well versed already in some particular regression techniques and whatever new things that you were not taught in econometrics, but that are conceptually quite understandable for you. So don't be afraid if you are in something that doesn't sound like data science, or maybe closer than you think to data science.
I think I feel like I know it. I know that my skills will work in this industry, but my CV doesn't show that right.
Okay, that's a recruiter problem.
Yeah.
that's really all that is. And
if you're able to get your CV to the hiring manager, that is the data science lead who really knows what matters and not bullet points, then it shouldn't be a problem.
Yeah. I would completely agree with that. And be very hesitant on recruiters. You'll probably, so this is like more of a career kind of process question, but usually I don't advise people. The only people that tend to have good luck with recruiters are people who are freelancing on a specific technology or framework, and they want to do billable hours on that framework, maybe on a part-time basis. For anyone else, I don't usually recommend to go with recruiters. There are a few recruiters out there that handle high-level kind of executive roles, and they are really good. But they've been doing that for 10, 20 years, and they're very specialized in that. The people who are recruiting for other roles, they're just looking for checkboxes. And to them, economics, anything econ, is going to be, oh, well, it doesn't say data science. So that's their world, and they're processing tons of resumes, so that's fine. So it's much better to just have... What I try to do, and I just think it's interesting, is I meet with people at different companies just to understand what kind of problems they have. And invariably, just by doing that, you'll meet some of these hiring managers, and they'll understand your background. One of the best hires I ever made was this person, and they had almost no technical experience in the things that we were actually doing, but they had built this robotic control system, like Android app. So they built an Android app so that they can control a robot, that they were like an industrial robot, like big one in Germany, and they were like playing with it with their phone. And I was like, that's, yes, that. But if he would have sent that to a recruiter, they would have totally rejected it, because it wasn't whatever framework version something something. So definitely talk with the hiring managers will help.
Is there anyone here who's a recruiter?
Yeah,
No, no, seriously, don't be shy.
Don't be afraid.
No, no, because, okay, then, so...
Yeah, go ahead, raise your hand.
I'm going to share with you in... Let me try to squeeze it in 2 minutes, how recruitment works, okay? So, when companies hire recruiters, different recruiters have different tiers. There's a tier one recruiter, tier two recruiter, tier three recruiter. So the tier one recruiter gets the job right immediately when it's available. And the tier two recruiter gets it a week after, the tier three recruiter gets it a week after. So the tier one recruiter has an advantage, right? So how do you keep as a tier one recruiter? You give them good resumes. Every recruiter can only give maybe 5 resumes, so you can't spam them resumes, but you can only give 5. So from the recruiter's perspective, how do they know if these resumes make the mark? To them, because they're not technical, they don't really have too much in-depth experience. For them, it's all about meeting the check marks. So that's how a recruiter works. So therefore, going through the recruiter route is actually a lower rate of success. And you know, as people say, going through the referral route, if you know friends in technology companies, talk to them, try to get them, give them your resume, because they know what they want as a teammate, or they know who they want to hire, you're going to have a better chance of success. So let me share with you an example. When I was trying to make a career change, I sent out, okay, the interview hit rate was 10%. So for every 10 resumes I sent out, I only had one interview invite. When I went through the referral route, the interview hit rate was 100%. So it's like, yeah.
Can I add something? Because for your background, my suggestion, I think one of mine has to be pretty deep with these things, I think it's fantastic. What he did actually, he go to LinkedIn, he started to search someone actually have a similar background to him. And then he's now getting a job, for example, the scientist. So now you're going to send out an invitation to join the CLA to have a catch up with these guys. Of course, you'll probably send out 10 emails and no one come back. If you send out the 50, there's one or two emails come back, then you probably want to catch up with that person, sharing with him, no understanding. One side, you probably learn from that guy. The other side, you probably get opportunity. He started referring to some junior positions, if possible, because today, I'm working for a lot of MNCs company. Recruiter is one side, and many times, their priority will be, if someone can refer this guy to me. So I know this guy, they have an internal referring program to keep on running every day. So if a colleague, if I'm working for this company, I'm going to the manager to see, I know this guy, his potential is good. Your chance of getting to be almost 100%.
Actually, to add on to that, right, I would say almost all the jobs that I have till now are all through referrals. Yeah, I can simply say that it's really 90% through referrals. I think that's the reason, that's one of the reasons why it's good to set up a community and really go and go out and network to other people, talk to other people. Show other people what you have done. Because this is a technical community, everyone will have sort of an idea as to what is required for that particular job. And they will be the right people to look at you and say that, yeah, I think you have the suitable skills for our company. I think that's one of the aim of having such a community.
Yep.
To really build up your network. Yeah.
I think at Lazada, more than 90% of our hires are referred for the data science team. Okay, so I want to touch on 2 points that Koo and Adam made. One point they made is, I think Koo made this, it's hard to be a data scientist if you don't have the basic software. Did I rephrase that correctly? Software
basic
experience?
Software.
Or I think Adam said that it's hard to be a data scientist without the basic software. Okay, so software engineering is one part of it. And Adam also said, document it, write it. So the essentially written communication. So what is the one thing that you think the audience can do to improve software engineering? Maybe Adam? One thing that they can do for an hour a day or 2 hours a day.
So there are a lot of sites out there where you can find programming challenges that are relatively small, relatively short. So one thing that a lot of people have trouble with is they don't know where to start. So they don't have any ideas. So they say, okay, well, I need to work on my software development skills. I need to be better at that. But what kind of project should I do? I don't know what to do. My advice, just go to HackerRank or something and start doing the practice exercises. They have tons of them, in all different areas. They even have a whole section, I think, on machine learning. And you can use all kinds of different languages. You can Python, Java, C++, Go, Haskell, Scala, Clojure, whatever you want. So that's kind of an easy way to do it. It's just really digestible. You can try to work on one of those or two of those a day, or whatever you want. So that's one thing. And on the writing, the best way to get better at writing is to write more. And the only reason, really, that you shouldn't be writing more is because you just physically don't have time to write more. It matters a lot. I cannot overstate how broad the effect is of having content and things that you've written out there, especially if you're thinking of transitioning into a data scientist role. The reason being that, let's say that you do the networking, the writing and the web presence is going to help you. Let's say that you get the interview. That's going to help you because people are going to look you up and they're going to form interview questions based on stuff you've already done, which is going to make your interview process a lot smoother and more comfortable. And then let's say that it works out and they want to hire you. Well, now they can't use that nice trick where they say, well, you're transitioning and we're not sure about your experience, so we're going to have to start you at a lower salary. Like, no, I've already done all this stuff before. So it gives you so many benefits. And if you're writing about things that you're doing anyway, the investment for you in terms of time is kind of minimal for the payoff that you get. So I 100% would say write more. Everything you do, every project you do, I was a couple of weeks ago, I wrote like a Twitter bot, which I haven't done in a couple of years, so I want to do another one. And the day or two after I finished it, in the morning, I just wrote up everything that I did and put the code on GitHub. It's part of my process that I do. I can't recommend it enough. It gives you so many benefits. Secondary, tertiary, just it really does cascade.
What about NDA?
Maybe we can let Koo finish.
You were gonna say something?
Yeah.
Oh, actually I just wanna sum it up, it's just start working on a project.
Yeah. But what project? People don't know where to start.
For me my recommendation is this, but this is my learning style. I would say the one that really kicked things off for me was actually Andrew Ng's machine learning course, which was on YouTube.
Which was important, right?
Yeah. So I started from there. I learned along the way as I watched the videos. Then I start, because of the keywords that was used to explain the videos, like all the calculus stuff, the linear algebra stuff, the cost functions and all these sort of provide me the keywords to actually take the next step, to do a Google search, see what comes up from there. So how to start a project, really just start something and move on from there using the keywords and learn from there. And now I have actually a long list of projects that I wanted to do. One of them I just shared with Adam yesterday was actually doing a chessboard. So what one of my retiring plans is to actually create chessboards for all the different chess. Then I'll like play with it during my retirement years. Like,
are you expecting to retire alone? The only person left on Earth.
If you have chess bots, you're never alone.
True. Yeah, I have like probably 7 or 8 AIs to work with me.
Who needs humans when you got AI?
Yeah. Okay. Anyway, yeah.
It's about writing and documenting your activities and your experience. What about MBA? I mean, usually, for example, I'm facing this problem every time when I come to interview. They ask me, "Do you have a GitHub account?" Yes, I have a GitHub account, but
GitHub. Yeah.
Yeah, I have a GitHub account, but there is 2 projects inside, and I have probably 50 of different projects in different companies, but they are under NDA.
Okay.
Yeah, how to obfuscate it? I don't know how. I mean. Probably you can describe your activities in some abstract way, not to disclose it.
I mean, I would recommend doing another project on your own time that wouldn't be covered.
So it's a bit difficult because so now we get into a little bit employment contract stuff. So if you go to work at a company, some companies will try to have in their employment contract that any idea you have while you're employed with them is their property. I don't know any country in the world where that's actually legally enforceable, first of all. Second of all, it sends a horrible message to the employees. So that's usually the first thing I try to get stripped out from contracts. So if that's your concern, that something you work on your own time will somehow be property of the company, there's technically a legal risk there, but it's pretty small. So if you're talking about it's under NDA because somehow of the employment contract, then that's I wouldn't worry about that. And not only that, I would probably raise some hell about it too, because that's just not cool, right? I mean, it's like saying you can't have your own ideas. That doesn't make sense. If it's under NDA because it was an actual work project, that's a different situation. Like, just professionally, ethically, you have to let that go. It's you don't even want to get into a situation where you kind of do a modified version of it or something like that and then try to release it, because people talk. And if someone knows that you're doing modified versions of your work code and then putting it on your GitHub, suddenly your trustworthiness is called into question. Which is horrible. So then in that case, I would agree with Eugene. You just do your own project.
A bad sign for your new employers.
It would be 100% a bad sign.
So for example, yeah. Google wouldn't hire someone who actually shares company code, right? Because Google shares all code.
But then we get to a different question, which is, there's a lot of code in companies that can be open sourced. And I've tried to do this in places where I've worked, where we actually segment out some of the code that's not proprietary, because most code's not. It's some kind of business stuff. So if it's something like that, then you may be able to find some kind of ally internally and start working with them and helping them understand why it would be important and helpful for the company to open source stuff. Then you can start getting that train rolling. Usually you have to sell it as a recruiting and retention benefit, something that's good for the public image of the company and so on, because that's what more of the business people care about, but that's another option too.
Or it's like getting the community to help you find bugs and fix them if you open source it.
Yeah.
Anyone have anything to add?
Very basic question. What platform would you recommend for to do your writing? Just give GitHub will be sufficient.
What platform?
Platform that you're writing on. Because I noticed you have a blog.
To publish it, do you mean?
Post-it notes.
Vim. Vim. So I don't want to start the Vim Emacs war, but Vim. So you mean publishing platform or like, or editor or, publishing, whatever you want. Anything to get it out there. It can be on WordPress, you can do GitHub pages, you can do static site, Medium, I don't know, you know some other ones?
LinkedIn.
Okay, I have a problem with that one, because I don't want them owning my content. So I want to keep my content. So I don't publish on LinkedIn, I don't have a Facebook account, but I keep all my content, so I don't write on LinkedIn.
Okay.
That's just me. Sure. But the answer is, write anywhere that you will actually write. That's the important part. So don't pick a place that's going to make it difficult for you to put the content out. Anywhere you feel comfortable or happy or motivated writing the stuff and publishing it, that's the place to choose. It's just a tool. It's just a channel for you to get your message out.
It's meant to be searchable.
Sorry?
It's meant to be searchable.
Yeah, so if you put the content on WordPress.com or something, it will be searchable on Google.
Yeah. I think, so Koo mentioned just now that he started off by doing machine learning classes from
Android.
And then he went on to calculus, you know, algebra, etc. So there are two questions here that are quite related to this. So why should we learn the math or computer science behind the tools/models we use? After all, most of them off the shelf seem to work well enough. We just need to optimize the parameters generally for true cost validation and deploy it. And then the other question is, what is the relationship between the theory of machine learning and the practice of machine learning for deployment from the point of an engineer? So someone who designs and builds stuff and deploys it as opposed to an academic doing research. So maybe the first question first, right?
First question first. What's the first question again? Sorry, I was.
Why should we learn the math and the computer science, the fundamentals? Why learn about old notation or linear algebra?
I think having a good understanding of maths, right, allows you or gives you a lot of flexibility in terms of like tweaking your algorithms later on, when you actually have a different situations. So what I mean by different situation is because, let's face it, I mean even company in the same industry, right, will have different business models, different business policies, regulations, different kinds of people working inside, and all these kind of stuff. And you need to be able to understand how to tweak all these algorithms so that you'll be useful in the particular context that you're working in. So I usually give a very common example is the difference between a rich regression and a lasso regression. You look at it, it's actually the regularization part, which is the one is absolute, the other one is squared. So what's the difference? Why a square, what if it's a square, right, what kind of impact will it have on the regularization? And what if it's absolute, what kind of impact will it have? So all this will come in the picture, and you have to think about how all these mathematics will then translate into a business context. What kind of impact will it have on business? So for any students that I come across in, I always recommend them that please don't say that you don't love maths at all. But I have to say, if you really want to be very proficient in data science, you can't run away from maths. You really can't run away from the maths part. And I have to say, I'm very lucky in a sense that I love maths a lot. Similarly, like Adam, I can sit down and solve a problem and spend 2 hours on it. I don't mind at all. I think it's perfect. It's just that maybe that sometimes the Greek letters sort of like haunts me during my sleep, but still okay, still manageable for me. I love it looking at all these mathematics problems. Okay.
So what about you, Adam?
So math. Some people think that the math is the implementation detail, right? Like they think, oh well, there's just some regularizer and that's the. But actually, it's the other way around. The algorithm is actually the implementation detail, because if you understand the mathematics that underlies all this stuff, then some particular algorithm is just some application of it. So if you get the linear algebra and the calculus and all these things, then a lot of machine learning things, for me, as someone who studied math, are kind of like more of an implementation detail. And that's very powerful, because you can transition between a lot of different concepts very easily. Whereas if you don't understand the underlying mathematics and you're learning everything case by case, then sometimes it can become very difficult. So that's one thing. But the main problem that people face when they're learning math stuff is that it's hard. And for some reason, they don't think it should be hard. And so then they think they're not good at math because it's hard. And I can't speak for everyone, but for me, math is really hard. I'm not the best at math. I did an undergrad and a master's in applied math, and I spent a lot of time around a lot of people who are a lot better at math than I was. And the thing that I learned is, one of the things that I learned, is that if you are doing math and you feel stupid, that's okay. That's okay. There's no problem with that. There's no problem with it. It's an area where when you're learning, you have to struggle with it. It's much different than some other areas where you can read a book and just kind of lightly skim the book. Maybe you're only halfway paying attention and you sort of get it. Math is not like that. You have to focus a lot and you have to mentally struggle a lot. But once you do that, the understanding you get is really profound. So what I see most often as the impediment to people learning math is the fact that they don't understand that it's going to be hard. And that doesn't make them bad at math. It doesn't make them incapable. It doesn't make them stupid. I mean, it's hard for me, so I do it anyway. And maybe that comes back to the discipline thing. Like you said, sit for 2 hours. There have been times where I sat for 2 hours with a problem, and I still didn't fix it. I still didn't solve it. And I came back the next day, and I tried to do it again. And then eventually, I figured it out. And for me, math is like that. You have to struggle with it. But once you do that, the understanding that you can get for these machine learning applications is really profound. It's really profound.
Okay, so I think we have time for one last question on the general data science track. I guess this question comes out a lot. Masters in data analytics courses cost a great deal. Recently, there are certifications from Microsoft, like the Microsoft Professional Data Science Program, Coursera Data Science Tracks. They are more affordable. How useful is it? And is it worth it, both time and money, assuming one finishes the course, for your own development and for employability?
What do you think?
Okay, I think it's a trap question for me, actually, since I'm teaching at the university.
You're on camera, don't forget.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. I would say it feels a different niche. There are some people who want a master's degree and also want to learn data science at the same time. Then of course a degree program helps disregarding the cost. So having said that, I would say it feels a different niche. It's up to you. I mean, for me, I kind of think I have self-discipline. to actually sit down and look at a problem, code it out, and all this. And so for me, maybe not a master's degree, but anyway, I have my master's already, which was in business admin. Yeah, so I would say it feels a different niche. So you have to ask yourself the question of a balance between cost and value. I mean, I as an economist background, I would say...
I think the general question is, like, these online certifications, data science tracks from Coursera, all this, is it worth the time and effort? Do you really get value of it for your own learning and for employability? And also there's the fact that I think if you throw a rock out in Singapore, almost everyone has one. So many people have doing it because ID is giving out a subsidy. In case you don't know about it, now you know. If you finish the data science track, you get $500 back, which is the cost of it, and you get $500 more. So you earn money by doing courses.
But the program ended earlier.
Oh, the program ended.
Yeah, the program ended.
Okay, sorry guys.
Program ended.
Yeah, so I mean, are these, what's your take on this? Like for people out here who are considering something like that.
So learning is always a good idea and it's never wasted. That's the first thing. Learning is never wasted. Whether you want to pay for the learning or not is kind of your call. That's really what it is. The primary benefit that I see from these kind of programs is that it allows people a bit of structure so that they can actually do some of the projects and some of the writing and stuff that we talked about earlier. Some people have a hard time doing that without a bit more structure, and that's fine. And I see the same benefit to some of the data science kind of boot camps or programs is you get a distilled curriculum that's focused, and you do projects as part of the program. And those projects get put up on the web so that employers and the community can see them. So you get that kind of exposure and practice. And usually there's some kind of presentation component as well, and that matters. So there are positive effects from doing something like that. But like Kus said, you don't necessarily have to go through that program to do it. It may be better for you from a time or a money perspective to do those things on your own. I think there's a GitHub repository somewhere, I can't remember exactly where, but I think it's called the Open Source Data Science Masters or something like
that.
And it's got all kinds of stuff in there. A lot of these programs make their curriculum freely available. The same thing for a lot of the boot camps. So like Data Science Retreat in Berlin, or I think Zipfian Academy, Insight, all of these places, they make it available. So you can actually see what they're doing. So then you have to ask the question, well, what's the benefit of paying for it? The benefit of paying for it is basically the structure and the network, I would say. You get a little more guidance, you get more structure to the learning part, and also to kind of the networking and the interaction with the community. So if you can do those things on your own, then you don't really need the program. If you're talking about employability, it's the same thing. I can't speak for everyone, but for me, if I'm in a situation where I'm a hiring manager, the fact that someone has a certification or a degree or whatever, it's an indicator or a signal, but it's not a sufficient condition of employability. And I mean that in the mathematical sense. I'm not going to employ someone just because they have a certificate or a degree. That might give interesting topics to explore or talk about during the interview, but I'm more interested in their projects. I'm more interested in the other kind of work that they've done, in the things they've finished, in how they communicate with other people, things like that. So I wouldn't advise anyone and say, yes, you should definitely get one of these certificates. But if it's going to help you and give you the structure you need to put together that public portfolio of projects and stuff, then you have to make the call whether or not it's worth it for you.
Okay. So I think we have four or five more questions that are related to general data science. I think, okay, so here's a challenge in conciseness and succinctness for our panelists. I'm going to ask you the question, try to answer it within 30 seconds. Okay?
Okay.
With what are the three must-know things that you expect from data scientists on your team? Cool.
I'll take 15 seconds to think.
You can take. You only have 30 seconds to answer. You can think as long as you want.
Okay, let's give two a break, Adam.
Okay.
Curiosity and tenacity. That's it. I only need two.
So,
what
Adam,
is the second
place?
Tenacity.
Okay. Tenacity slash discipline. What about?
I will say interpersonal skills, plus also logic thinking.
It's amazing. None of them said Python, Spark. Okay. So what is the next big thing in machine learning / data science? Adam.
How quickly a lot of it's going to evaporate.
Cool.
I would say AI actually. I mean, I'm not going to go with the, it's not going with the trends and all this, but I think AI is something that we will move towards next when it comes to data science. But having said that, I'm not saying that they're equal. I think I put up an article before on a Facebook page. Is these three are very separate.
You have 10 more seconds.
So read out that article. Yeah.
So look for Koo's article on where?
No, it's not mine. It's actually from Data Science Central, if I'm not correct. Okay. Yeah. So it actually separates all these three out. Please read them up, because nowadays I'm seeing a lot of people saying that they know AI, but actually what they know is machine learning. Mm. Yeah.
So I'll give my real answer now. My real answer is I've been a big fan of streaming analytics and reinforcement learning for a long time. And I think that's going to become a more important issue as people want to analyze data while it's in motion, because it just becomes too expensive to analyze it after it's been stored. So if you want my guess, also a lot of people talk about Internet of Things. That's kind of part of it. That's not really the main issue, but reinforcement learning in general and streaming analytics.
Okay, I guess kind of related to the previous, Adam's first response. Is data science just a short-term hype?
Is this also a 30-second one? Because that's a more than a 30-second one. So
30 seconds.
Is it short-term hype? In its current form, yes. Because it's going to change.
What's its current form?
So you get a lot of people who are selling the result instead of the process. So people are selling this concept of data science because they want to have what companies who talk about data science have. They want to have what Google has. They want to have what Facebook has. They're not actually talking about the process of getting there. They just think they're going to, whatever. They're going to set up a Hadoop cluster like Google, and then they're going to make money like Google. And companies are figuring out that it doesn't work that way. So I think in that sense, expectations are going to be mitigated and more appropriate, which is good for all of us, actually. So is it short-term hype? There is some hype right now. I think it'll die down, but it's not going to go away.
Cool.
I agree with Adam on the last sentence. So, but generally, when I share with other people, I said that there are three questions you need to ask yourself. Will technology improve? Answer is yes, technology will improve. Second thing is, with technology improve, right, do you think companies are going to stop collecting data? I don't think so. That's an yes. Because companies are going to still keep on collecting data. So the third one is, are they going to let the data sit down there and rot? But if it rots, answer is no again. So I would say data science is here to stay. But yes, it could be a hype for now. But okay. It's definitely here to stay.
So I'm overwhelmed by how fast the industry moves. How do I keep up? What should I prioritize on? Anyone?
Whatever that keeps your job.
So I'll disagree. I'll say the thing that's going to keep your job is important, but it's not the main focus. The main focus, I always advise people, is to look at transferable skills. That's going to be communication and math, because that will take you to any other job. So if you understand the CS fundamentals and the math fundamentals, when new languages or frameworks or algorithms or whatever come out, you can read the research paper and you'll get it pretty quickly. So that's going to be a lot better time investment. And because who cares if there's some new JavaScript framework for front-end development? I mean, that might be useful or interesting, but that's not something that's going to make me really concerned. So the main thing is to focus on the fundamental transferable skills, because then you can learn these new things very, very quickly.
Okay, so another question. How do you see the market for data science / data scientists? I think you answered that already. How does it compare from 3 years ago, and how do you anticipate 3 years from now it's going to grow? The last question. Which sectors in particular are receptive or have the greatest potential?
Sorry, which one?
Which sectors have the greatest potential for data science?
I think if you're looking from a management perspective, like profit centers are the one that will actually definitely have a lot of potential when it comes to data science. But having said that, there is an outlier, and the outlier is actually risk and compliance, which is seen as a call center. But risk and compliance is a place where I think data science would flourish. And you can safely say that So someone was telling me this actually, if you were to choose, like, will you work in a profit center or will you work in the call center? I said, okay, if you want to work in a call center, please make sure it's risk and compliance. Even during a recession, right, there's no way they're going to cut down the compliance department. So you can choose. So make sure that you go to a profit center. That's where there'll be a lot more data science. Oh, okay. Then, yeah, if it's a call center, make sure it's compliance and risk.
So can you restate the question?
Which sectors in particular are receptive or have potential for data science in the next 3 to 5 years?
Okay, so this is kind of, well, I don't know if it's an unpopular perspective, but insurance. Actuarial studies is kind of like the original data science, in my opinion. It's like application of statistics and math to a particular business problem. It's been around forever. And insurance companies have a lot of money and they know that they're sort of floundering. The other thing is a lot of new startups are coming up and building completely new insurance products that didn't exist 5 years ago. Because we have data now, so we can calculate risk on things that we weren't able to calculate before. So insurance is an interesting one. Fintech's getting a lot of press right now. I'm less optimistic on that one. I think a lot of it's going to be algorithmic trading and things, but I think it's still too early to say that that's going to come. But insurance, definitely, I see as one. And I would agree with Ku that if you're going to go into a company, go for a profit center. Yeah. Cost center, no chance. No chance. Because companies respond a lot better, and people respond a lot better to areas where you can make them more money than when you can save them money. You can only save a finite amount of money, but you can increase revenue by a much different amount.
Okay, I know a lot of people are looking forward to the leadership part. Two more questions. With the growing competition in the field, how do I stand out from the crowd? Cool.
You can't just say get a degree from wherever.
Yeah. How do you stand out from a crowd? I would say,
if you're hiring, what makes someone stand out from the crowd?
I would look at the projects. I would look at the projects that they do. And from there, I would see how interesting or how complex the project is. I mean, of course, the more complexity that is involved, then I'll definitely probe further and to actually sort of like support that this person is actually going to be outstanding as compared to the others.
Yeah.
So, I agree. It's about the projects. I think the other issue to consider and how you want to take advantage of this in your own situation is up to you. But I do see more fragmentation in the field than I did a few years ago. So 3-5 years ago, people would just hire a data scientist and they would do kind of everything. And now, depending on the company, you might have someone who's not a data scientist, but they're a recommender systems engineer or something. Much more specific, much more focused. So if you have areas like that which are interesting for you, it could make sense to spend more time focusing on those. But other than that, it really is the projects standing out. Well, I mean, you're already standing out because you're here and everybody else is maybe still sleeping. So the fact that you're doing stuff while other people are sleeping is a good approach. If you keep doing that, then everything else kind of take care of itself.
Okay, so this is a tough question to answer in 30 seconds. But how should one prepare for a data science interview? Maybe there's no way to answer this.
Do projects.
Projects. Showcase really, your project.
Showcase your project, yes. I think the projects will be the one that really tells your employer what you can do and what you can't do for now.
Okay.
It gives you a very good gauge as to your current skill set, and at least the hiring managers will be able to ask the right question and also be able to gauge whether you are going to be a good fit into the company as well. Yeah.
So two things I would say. One, practice and learn how to guide conversations. Once you get into an interview, you should take the first opportunity to turn the interview around so that you start interviewing them. And that's a skill, and you can learn it, and it's something that is extremely valuable. And once you have the ability to steer conversations like that, you will have a lot more success in interviews. Because you can control which questions get asked or which questions you answer or how long you spend on different questions. So that's one thing. The other thing is, if you want to be successful in an interview, it helps if the interview is just a formality. So if you already kind of know the company and the people and what they're working on and the projects and the challenges and problems and all that stuff,
that gives you a lot of opportunity to guide the interview. And you can focus on how you can contribute to those things. So one thing is just conversational skills, like learning how to guide a conversation. And you can do that in an interview. You can run the interview, even if you're the one applying for the job.
Yeah.
That's totally fine. There's nothing wrong with that. Then the last thing as a side note is take the mental perspective that you are the one who's interviewing the company and they have to convince you. They need to sell you on why you should be there. Even if you don't think that's true, just take that mental perspective and it will really change the way you conduct your interviews.
I think Adam makes a good point. So a lot of companies claim they want to hire data scientists and then they join, they realize they've been working on Tableau dashboards for a year. So I guess most people here, or maybe some people here don't want to do that. So as an interviewee, as an applicant, you really have to ask them, how's your database like? What will I be doing in the first 3 months? What do you want me to deliver? What do you want me to achieve? And if their achievement is management visibility of metrics, then
run.
Yeah, run this.
I'll just say thank you and walk out the door.
Well, I mean, don't literally run.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's enough time for general data science questions. Of course, will you guys be around after this? Our panelists will still be around after this. So now I'm going to move on to the more leadership related questions. So one question is, how do I deal with non-technical superiors or leaders who are not technical but think they are and try to overly manage things? So I'm sure none of us here has a boss like that, right? So we're safe.
Did you write the question? Huh? Did you write the question?
No.
Okay, add you on LinkedIn to see who's your boss? No.
Okay, I think this question comes out like quite a few times when I was discussing with a few friends. So generally, I think we need to find out a bit more as to why they behave that way. Buy coffee, buy lunch. we have to find out a bit more why they behave that way, I would say. Then from there, then we can actually really find a good solutions to it. So I would have to say it really depends on the person and on the situation. But more importantly is, I feel, if a person actually behaves that way, right, don't openly say that he behaved that way. That's the most important. Don't openly do that. Then go a bit separate from the rest of the people. But and if the boss is actually something that's receptive, then slowly bring across a message. Don't make a heavy impact, but slowly seep in your message. Yeah, that's the most important. Because once you get them more defensive, right, there's no way you're going to get through the thick skull anymore. Yes.
Yeah. That is true.
Okay. So I would say, first, take a very different mindset about dealing with them and feel sorry for them. Which sounds kind of weird, but stay with me for a second. So you're not the only one who knows they're doing this. So other people know this too. And imagine, aren't aware of this, but imagine what it's like to have a bunch of people thinking that you're just this horrible person that doesn't know anything. I mean, you should feel bad for them, right? It really sucks. It really sucks. So the first thing I would say is mindset shift. Start feeling bad for them. Then start figuring out how you can try to help them. Which should not be such an issue now that you've had this mindset shift, right? Because now you feel bad for them, so you know you're a good person, so you want to help them out. That's the way I would approach it. Then you can start doing things that might be useful for them and try to over-deliver. Because the reason they're probably micromanaging is because they don't trust. Why don't they trust? Because maybe they have trust issues, who knows. But the point is you got to build that trust. And that means you have to find ways to make them look good. Remember, you're not here to be right, you're here to win. And if that means you make your boss look good for a while so that they get promoted or go somewhere else or give you more freedom or you have room to operate, you win. So that mindset shift helps to suppress your ego so that you're not constantly trying to be right or, you know, defensive or whatever with the boss. You feel bad for them. because it's a bad situation for them. You do what you can to help them, which then helps to build up the trust, and then you start to win because you get the autonomy and the freedom. So, step one, mind shift change.
I think it's one way to prevent this problem is also, like we mentioned, the interview. Interview your potential boss if he's going to be an idiot who doesn't know anything but just says, hey, the best way to increase conversion is doing something ridiculous. So the interview is really the best time for you to figure out if your teammates are good, if your boss is good, and you want to work with them. And I think to summarize what Adam and Koo said, take ownership. It's not their fault that they are micromanaging you. It's your fault that you're not communicating to them well enough in a way that they can understand, and you're not persuading them of what's the right course of action. Okay, so next question. How would someone know if they are more suitable for the technical track versus the management track, other than trying it?
Other than trying it, wow. That was like...
So I mean, of course, anyone can just try to be a manager and then, oh, I suck at this. I prefer to just write code, not attend meetings. Or someone can just, oh, I don't have to write code. Is there any way that you yourself feel that, hey, this is what I like?
I would say not, don't try it. I think regardless, you really have to try it. But
yeah,
I think you have to find an environment where the cost of trying it is lower. I think that would be something that makes more sense. So where are these environments that allows you to actually try it out at a lower cost? And I would say doing group projects during your lessons or doing in, I mean, for the students.
Okay.
Yeah, but for those who are mid-career now, maybe gather a group of people to work on a similar project. Then talk to these people, interact with these people, network with these people. Then I think it will be good. So it helps with the network. It helps with your reputation. And yeah, it could be a lower cost. I'm not saying that it won't be.
So try to be a leader, but not at work.
Yeah, not at work. Maybe somewhere else where it's not like a 24/7 thing that you need to be.
So I would say first, you don't necessarily have to choose. That's one thing. There are some companies where you don't have to choose, so it depends on where you work. Hopefully you work at a company where they value their technical people. Mm-hmm. So there's a technical career progression that doesn't require you to go do management stuff. The other thing I would say as some kind of red flags for yourself internally, if you're thinking that you want to do leadership and management stuff because you want more money or better title or something like this, please don't. You're going to make everything worse for all of us. It's not about that. The number one thing is you have to do it because you want to help the people, and you really have to care about them. Like, you really have to care. You have to. They have to be like your own children. It's like that. And if you're not really that interested to deal with people, then don't do it. It's pretty straightforward. It's not a big deal. It's not a problem. I've done experiments before where people have come to me and said, I'm kind of interested to do some leadership stuff, but I don't know if I'll be any good at it. And I always frame this as an experiment. I say, okay, that's no big deal. We can try this out for like 2-3 months. We'll see how it goes. And if you like it, we don't have to keep doing it. And if you like it and it works out, then we can keep it up. So frame it as an experiment. And I do this with a lot of things. People are really hesitant to do things if they think it might fail. But if you call it an experiment explicitly, then for whatever reason, suddenly people are okay with it. So frame everything as an experiment. It will really cut down on the defensiveness. And then you can, like Koo said, you can try it out. Because it's an experiment, right? Why not? The other thing is, like we were talking about earlier, leadership is influence. So you don't have to be like promoted or put into some kind of management role to actually do leadership stuff. You know, you start by leading yourself every day. And the influence that you have with your bosses, with your peers, whatever, that's also an opportunity for you to exercise leadership. And you can kind of figure out if that's something you want to invest in or you don't. And either way is fine. But what I see as a problem for a lot of people is when they do it for money or kind of career, fame, things like this. I've had people literally come to me and say, oh, all my friends are bugging me because I'm not a senior architect something. You can cut my salary. Just give me a better title and make me a manager. It's like, no. No. So it does happen. So if that's the reasoning, maybe not the best idea. But if you want to help people and take care of people, then it's a pretty nice gig.
Yeah. Yeah, based on Adam's response, I'm actually quite surprised that care for people is actually not on your slide.
Oh, it is?
11, humility and discipline.
If you're humble, then you're able to.
That's true. At Google, they found that the number one trait that predicts whether a manager will be good or not in terms of team performance, whether the team likes them, is actually whether the manager actually cares for them, whether the team actually feels that the manager cares for them. They ask them daily, hey, what blockers you have, or if something happened in the family, they're like, oh, you know what? Yeah, so I think that's the main thing.
Actually, can I add on to that? I think I was thinking of is one of the characteristics, right, that I really think will help a data scientist is actually empathy. Being able to put yourself in the other person's shoe. So why I say that is, let's say for instance, if you're doing a presentation, you're able to put yourself in the management's shoes, able to think like, what do they really want from the presentation? That helps. If you're a team lead, if you have empathy, you're able to put yourself in the other person's shoe. And anytime when you give them like instructions, or you give them any like constraints and all these, at least you get their buy-in. And empathy, when you talk to other stakeholders, like maybe people in the data engineering department, you're able to communicate to them, you empathize with the constraints that they work with, they are more willing to actually work with you, I would say. So one of the key people skill that I feel a data scientist should have is actually empathy, being able to put yourself in the other person's shoe. Yeah.
Okay, so in line with this, what is the sacrifice required when you move from a technical position to a management position? So I can think off the top of my head, oh, I need to attend more meetings, I won't be able to write as much code, I won't build things myself as much. I have to sell my team so I can get more budget, I have to sell my team so I can get more money to buy clusters. Some people don't like to sell stuff, me included. So, but what do you think?
I don't want to go first.
Okay. So, there can be a lot of sacrifices, but if you enjoy what you're doing, then it's not really a sacrifice. So, it's more like a change. So, I wouldn't be opposed to having a job where I could write code all day and just kind of chill out with my editor. That'd be nice. But what I found is that eventually, the kind of impacts I can make in a company are limited for me. As an individual contributor, because I cannot scale my brain any more than the code that I can write. So leading teams is kind of a way to work together with other people and scale my brain out, and teams of teams and so on and so on. So if you make that choice, you're making a trade-off. You're going to have to maybe go to more meetings. You're going to have to deal with more people, more politics. Sometimes the sacrifices can be severe and political. There have been cases where I've had to use a lot of political capital to get people raises because it was the right thing to do as a leader, but it cost me a lot personally. There have been cases where I have left jobs over the years so that other people wouldn't have to take pay cuts. And those are the kind of things you have to be willing to do. You literally have to be willing to put other people before yourself. And if you're not willing to do that, then you may want to ask whether or not you're ready for a leadership and a management role. Because it goes deep when you care about the people. If you're in a situation where you're leading a big team of people, and you know that there has to be a budget cut, and it's going to be your salary or someone else, you're going to have to make the call. And you're going to have to live with whatever that decision is. So sometimes there are real sacrifices like that. But in general, it's extremely rewarding. So if you want to take care of people like that, do it. You won't regret it.
What about you, Kool?
I kind of agree with what Adam has mentioned so far. So I don't think there's any sacrifice if it's something that you enjoy doing. And if you want to, you can see yourself as a mentoring role as well as a leader. Because I would see myself as a mentor when if I'm in a leadership position, I would love to grow many of minions of yourself.
Minions.
many people of me, that kind. So that can actually that's how we can actually scale up faster and faster. Better or not, that depends. But definitely faster. So I don't see that as a sacrifice if it's something that you would love to do. I would say most of the data scientists like to create impacts, positive impacts especially. So I think being put in a leadership position actually gives you a position where you can actually create a bigger impact as compared to being a single person in the team. Yeah.
Okay, so with that in mind, what is the different skill sets required for someone transitioning to a leadership or management position as opposed to being a data scientist? So being a data scientist, you need software, communication. I assume leadership also requires a lot of communication, if not more. But what else is different? So if people want to move into that kind of role, how should they prepare for it so they don't fail?
Okay, if you're going to get into a leadership position, right, you definitely have to communicate to more people, more stakeholders, as compared to individuals in your team. And having said that, right, I think it's always good, again, like I said, you need to be able to empathize with your different stakeholders. But empathy is such a general word, right? How do you even go about doing it? I feel is you need to be able to understand the technical skills that are involved with the different stakeholders. Like if, let's say if you're a data engineer, what are kind of technical skills that's important, what kind of constraints do they have, and all this. So as a leader of a data scientist, as a leader of a team of data scientists, I would say you need to even know more than what your current team knows. But of course, not when I say know more, doesn't mean that you have to know more in depth, but more of like you have to be a bit more generalist rather than a specialist really.
So I think the communication becomes even more important. And not just written communication, but also interacting directly with people. So as an example, I worked with somebody, I don't know, 5 years ago or something, and this person wanted to transition into a leadership role, but they had a very difficult time communicating verbally. They were a very quiet person. So even if you were in a meeting with them at a table, a normal sized table, it would become difficult to actually understand what they were saying. And it seems like that's a small thing, but it actually matters a lot when it comes to humans. Not just from a communication kind of efficiency perspective, but also from a psychological perspective. If you're sitting with someone and they're quiet to the point where you can't even really hear them, then it can be difficult for a lot of people to take them seriously as a leader. So we had to come up with exercises. So I would take him into a really big room, and I would stand on the total other end of the room, and we would have a conversation like this. And I helped him with some breathing exercises that he could do at home to become more comfortable taking larger breaths, and things like this. And there are a bunch of tiny things, but these kind of communication things really add up. Written, verbal, you have to be able to project your voice and give presentations, which is something that a lot of people who are in a development team maybe aren't used to doing and aren't comfortable doing. You have to, like Ku said, you have to have a different perspective, a broader perspective. You have to understand what the business wants and why, which is maybe different. You have to understand that a lot of times the business doesn't care about anything technical. It's totally irrelevant to them. If you start talking about technical stuff, you're basically wasting their time and making them frustrated, and they don't feel smart, and then you've already lost the audience. It's already bad at that point. Everything's done. So the way that you frame the communication becomes a lot more important. Tact becomes a lot more important. You're interacting with people who have a lot more authority, both real and imagined. So that's difficult. So I would say those are all things that you need to change.
How does one practice that?
Practice what?
Gain the ability to communicate. Interact with people who are not easy to interact with. How does one gain tact? This political correctness thing.
So tact is like empathy, right? Yeah. I mean, if you're empathetic, then you have a bit more tact. And the other thing, I'll go back to it again, is like you're not there to be right. You're there to win, right? And those are not the same. And many people don't care. They want to feel good and they want to feel right. Even if they don't want to necessarily even be right, but they just want to feel right.
Yeah.
And so finding ways, empathetically, yeah, where you can do that and still make progress, that's how you win. And it takes practice, basically. I mean, there's no magic to it. You just have to interact with people more. That happened to me years and years ago. I realized, okay, technically I'm really comfortable, but what's actually
holding me back and what's an impediment for me is my interpersonal skills. I need to give more talks, I need to talk with more people, I need to understand more about people. Because if you're a tech person, the humans are like undocumented APIs. You're just sort of like poke and you try to figure out, and sometimes you hit this endpoint and you get this response and sometimes not, and you don't really understand why.
It's not really, really reliable.
Yeah, it's not necessarily reliable, and it's like, that's basically how I approach the problem. It's like, every time I'm interacting with a person, I'm basically exploring an undocumented API. Like, I get the human API, but there are sometimes the endpoints aren't quite what you expect. And so that's kind of how I approach it. And it really is case by case. And Alex earlier was saying, have one-to-ones with your people. It's one of the best tools that you have as a leader. And it's true. And the reason it's true is because people are different. There are some things foundationally that are the same, but motivators are different. Reactions to certain things are different. Some people are great under stress. Some people aren't. Some people you want to present information to a certain way, and other people would become totally defensive and wouldn't be able to accept it at all. Yeah. So it's really... just for me, it was changing the way I perceive human interaction. Yep. Instead of exchanging information, because that's how I used to perceive it. I was like, okay, this is an information exchange, you know. And I realized we're doing UDP, not TCP/IP, so it's totally different, right? You really have to just change your perception, kind of like with the boss story, right? Mm-hmm. If you start to feel bad for the boss, then it changes the way you interact with the bad boss, right?
Yep.
But it's the same with people.
So I think this question may not arise so much when a data scientist is trying to transition into a leadership role, because they already have the basic technical skill sets, right? But for companies that are trying to hire a data science head of data science, is technical skill set important? So let me phrase it this way. On one hand, many people say that yes, you hire a head of data science and he's supposed to hire people who are better than him. Right? Because that's, you hire people better than you so that they can do the job better. On the other hand, at Google, when they hire project managers or program managers, there's a requirement that the project or program manager has to be at least as technical as the team. I don't know what that means, as technical as the median of the team or the least technical person of the team, but what's your take on that?
Okay. I think as a good leader, the first thing you want to do is to sort of like secure the trust of your team. I think that's the most important. If you don't even secure the trust of your team, like, I think your leadership position won't be sustainable. So having said that, right, so what's important to build that trust? I think having a good understanding of technical skills, have that, because then again, you'll be able to, again, goes back to being empathized with the required amount of work. I mean, how many of us have come across this situation where, wow, my manager just keep on telling me to do this A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and all these, well, all these requirements, but have you done it before? It's like, you know what, you understand what I mean? It's like, if you feel that your manager doesn't understand what you're doing, you don't buy in to your manager. You don't trust your manager anymore. So for me, I feel that the technical skills, yes, is a requirement actually. For at least for a leader of a data science team, so that you can actually be able to understand the work required and also get the buy-in, that's one. Second thing is also easier for you to understand the requirements on the team and be able to request for the necessary resource outside the team.
So how does that gel? So for example, Ku is very good at risk management and compliance, right? He works in a company. So suddenly now he's head of data science and he needs to find someone to help him with data science in a marketing problem. So Ku definitely doesn't have the skill sets for that. He definitely is not as technical as the person. So will the person still be able to trust Ku?
Okay, if the trust is not there, I think the second thing would be you need to show other people that you're receptive to ideas. I feel that if a manager doesn't show that you're receptive to ideas, right, the flow of ideas to you will actually slow down, and in fact maybe just stop totally. And what will happen is that there will be a lot of back talking about you, or this leader sucks and all this, and the morale of the team actually will drop after that. So if you really boil down, I think it's a matter of you have to give a perception that you are receptive to ideas.
Yeah, it's just like Ku said, it comes down to technical empathy.
if you don't understand the burden on the team, then it's really difficult to manage both the expectations of the team and the expectations of the rest of the business.
Yep.
So I think some level of technical capability is required. With that being said, though, I don't think it's extremely high. So as a leader, I in fact would say I might be using my time poorly if I think I need to be as capable and as much of an expert as every person in my team in every area, especially as you get into larger teams. So if you have a team of 50, 100, 200 people, they're going to be there's a lot more expertise in that team than you have. So I think being comfortable, like Ku said, with that fact and saying, I'm not the expert. I have an idea. I can try to help and provide guidance, but it's up to you as a team to figure out the specifics, and I want to help you do that. That's a much better approach. So to do that, you don't need so much technical background, but definitely enough so that you understand the struggles that people have with their work. And that's why when I'm advising companies and I talk with CTOs, for example, they say, oh, I'm so busy, I don't have any time to write code. And I say, well, you need to carve out 20% or so of your time so that you can actually be in the code, so that you can understand what people are dealing with, so that when they complain about technical debt or some test coverage being poor or whatever it is, that you actually have some empathy for them instead of that just being a metric. So I think it's important, but it's not critical to be as technical as the median technical person on the team or something like that.
So there's a minimum threshold so you can understand the constraints your team faces and you can clear blockers for them.
Yeah.
As well as you can explain and not oversell to your stakeholders as well. Okay, so then one question is about more of managing a team. So if my company is set up on a bell curve and I think everyone on my team is a superstar and some people are going to get gigantic raises, some people are going to get, I don't know, 3%, some people are not going to get raises. I don't think that's fair. What can I do?
You want a break? I'll take it.
Yeah, I think
okay, cool. So this is a common thing. Different companies have different performance review processes. And are we still on 30-second clock?
No.
Okay.
But we will stop at 12:30.
Okay. At 12:30. Okay, so this.
And there's one more question after this.
There's a little more to this one because it goes into salaries, and it's important for people to kind of understand this a bit. So I wrote an article a while ago. I think it was called "What's Your Current Salary?" or something like this, because HR departments and recruiters love to ask this question. Oh, what salary are you on? Oh, what's your current salary? Never ever tell them. Here's the reason: when you have this kind of stack ranking situation or bell curve or whatever it is, the companies pay money to go out into the market and figure out what the salary distribution looks like for your job. So there are companies out there who the only product they sell is basically the information on salary distributions. So the company will map your job onto this kind of template job, and then this company will say, okay, well, for this template job, the 50th percentile salary is whatever, and they'll give quartiles or whatever they give, and then the company will decide based on that what kind of raises they want to do. And they'll say, we want to get our people to P45, which is like 45th percentile is sort of where we're going to sit. And companies will never disclose this, because if they did, then everyone would know that they're underpaid, for example. So the issue with the ranking actually goes one level deeper, and it's about how HR departments and companies set their performance review process and the salary adjustments that come from that. Then you get to your question of, if you have this process and you don't think it's fair, what can you do about it?
As a leader and as an employee.
So, depends on the size of the company. If you work at a massive company that does this, just leave. Really, you're not gonna be able to make much progress there. And as a side note, for people who are in like the first 10 years or so of their career, don't worry about getting a raise at your job. Change your job. Seriously. Don't stay at your job. You're going to get a much bigger raise and a much bigger increase in responsibility by changing the company. You could get 30, 40, 50 or more percent raise by changing the job. If you stay at a company, they're benchmarked to that distribution. They're probably not going to give you more than a few percent, 5, 6 maybe, depending. I mentioned there was a time where I had to expend a lot of political capital to get raises for a whole team almost.
there were people who got 30% raises. We did a market adjustment for people, and it was needed. But you have to have a leader who's really willing to do battle for you to make that happen. So if you're at a big company, just leave. And if you're at a, if you're in the first years of your career, also leave. Every 2 years-ish, 3 years-ish, you're not going to learn much more after that at that particular company. And even if you could, they're not going to pay you for your experience. They're not going to give you market rate for your experience. So the thing to consider is, what am I worth on the market? Not what are they paying me, what am I worth on the market? And if that gap becomes more than about 20%, that's when people start moving. You can't really change the performance review process as an employee. If the company is big enough, you can't change it as a leader. You can try to play games with it. I don't advise that. The issue is that it doesn't appropriately recognize people who have different strengths. It puts everyone on the same standard, which some people like it because they think, oh, we're all equal. We're not all equal. We all have different areas where we can focus. So
I think there's going to be a lot of attrition after today.
No, I'm always really open about this, and even for people on my team, it's like there are limits to what I always go by market rates. So for people on my team, I always try to make sure that they're set at market rates. I don't care if HR says we can only do a 4% raise or whatever it is. That's not my problem. That's not my problem. That's a business problem that they didn't factor that in.
So just to add on that, let's suppose my company is a worker system, right?
Uh-huh.
And fighting with the HRB is a long-term battle. And a reason of this worker system causes a conflict, right? Because as a data science team, people are smart, that's an assumption, right?
Right.
If the people is not smart, you wouldn't want smart people to your team.
Right.
But if you create this worker system, and all, I think all of us know the negative penalties of it, then how can I, in the best short-term interest, manage this among my employees? Because if it's a worker system, I would want to put my colleague down so that I can have my salary up.
Uh-huh.
Right, but that's the way the game is played. So as a boss, how can I design a system that despite this worker system, my employees will still be happy?
Okay.
Right. What can I do?
So what else can you do? That's the question, right? So what I've done in the past is a lot of companies have these kind of bonus programs that they don't really talk about. But if you press HR hard enough as a leader, so this is like if you're working directly with HR, right? Then you can say, look, this raise thing is a bunch of crap because my people, their market rate is increasing 15% per year and you're telling me I'm going to give them 4? That's insulting to them. And by the way, they deserve more than that. So is there some kind of performance bonus system that exists? And many companies will have a budget set aside just for this purpose. And then you can start allocating performance bonus to people on your team. Even though you can't give them a raise because it's not allowed by the process, you can supplement the revenue, the income, basically, for them. But you won't be able to change the actual thing.
But this is a bit contradicting, right? Because okay. Like, in a sense, like a company, right? If I give somebody a performance bonus, I will not pay somebody else. What's the doctor system, right? It's not
No. So a lot of these performance bonuses, it's a fixed budget that's allocated at HR. It's whatever. $5 million for performance bonuses, right? And then it's actually up to different leaders at different levels, and they usually have an allocation limit. So you can allocate $2,000, $5,000, whatever dollars to your people, subject to approval of HR. So it's not like you take 5 from one and you give to the other. It's not like that. Usually it's pre-allocated as part of the budget, if the company does it. But the simple fact is companies typically don't do market adjustments, because the market moves faster than the company does, and it doesn't allow them to predict their financial, to do financial forecasts and all that stuff. So, change a job. Sorry, it's true. It's true.
As a leader, you need to fight for your team.
Sorry.
As a leader, you need to fight for your team.
You can fight. That's right. But especially for people in our industry, the market rates are for data science over tech people are changing at a rate that business people aren't comfortable with. Because people in sales or marketing, their salaries aren't going up like that. So then you get to the actual politics of this. So when you get to like a board or an exec team level, you're going to have people in a finance team, they're saying, well, why are we allocating all this extra budget to tech? And it's usually kind of a back and forth. So yeah, you can definitely fight for your team. And sometimes you can win. But sometimes the best thing you can do for people on your team is to help them find their next better job. Really. And that's, again, it comes back to the fact, are you doing the best thing for the people? Do you care most about the people? And of course, you have to care about the company first. But I tell you, if you do the right thing for the person, you're automatically doing the right thing for the company. Because if you're not helping them to find that next better job, they're going to do it on their own, which means they're going to do it on their time. And they're not going to tell you about it. So you have no way to prepare. So if that situation is going to transpire anyway, why not help them out and be able to have more information about it? It's just better for everybody.
Okay.
Oh.
Sorry? Oh, of course. Of course. Well,
once you have a reputation for somebody who really cares about their stuff, yeah. It's easy to get them.
Yeah, I've never, historically, that's something that I get asked. So when I'm working with companies, like, how do you manage recruitment and how do you find tech people? There are no tech. Every company says that there's a tech talent shortage. No. There's a shortage in the sense that you don't want to pay for the tech talent. That's good. If you don't want to pay market rates, you're not going to get people. That's just the way it is. So there's no shortage of good people. And so I've never had, personally, I've never had an issue with recruiting. That's never been something that was challenging for me. So for me, I'd be much happier to help that person move on to something that's a better fit for them than I would trying to make them stay there and convincing them why it's just not ideal.
Okay, I think one last question. So given that most of the big data hype is still around with senior management whereby, okay, press a button, get an answer, increase in revenue, how do you as a data scientist bring them from this big data machine learning magic to more realistic expectations? So like, it's not like we build a cluster today, tomorrow revenue goes up 2x.
I think you have to take an education approach. I think there's no magic pill for this. But I'm pretty sure most management are smart. They will they will be able to actually take what you give it to them. But again, like I said, don't put them on defensive. Don't put them on defensive, but go from a point of education, educating them that there are certain limitations. And all this, and also understand why they have such a viewpoint as well. Because sometimes they actually read it from somewhere else, and they bring it to the table and say that, oh, this is what I've learned. But of course, they won't say that this is what I've learned. They'll just say that this is what I know. So having said that, it'll be good to actually understand why they have that kind of thinking, why they will have that kind of thoughts, and then move on from there and start educating them that. This is the kind of expectation you can get from data science. Talk to them a bit more. Relate to them a bit more. Because I heard a lot, like for instance, there are some management who says that, oh, data science, you mean 100% accuracy? No, not 100% accuracy. But you get closer. But you tell them that you get closer. So you try to find like a common point or the same page. A common point and use it as an anchor, and then you move towards each other rather than saying that, oh no, you're the one who's not so smart, I'm the one who's smarter, listen to me. That will put them on the defensive rather. And somehow I feel most of the time it's because of the lack of information, because they're not the technical people. So buy them lunch, it helps. I mean, if it's like $15 and it makes your job easier once a month, why not? Yeah.
So I, first of all, agree with everything that Ku said. It's really important to interact with those people because, again, it comes back to influence. And who's the one influencing them? The salespeople at Cloudera or you? That's it. The vendors are going to be doing their job. They get paid for that. They get commissioned for that. So if you are not countering that influence with your own perspective and internal domain knowledge of what's actually going on in the company, then you're losing. You're basically losing the information battle because you don't want to deal with the problem. The problem's not going to go away. Like I said, those vendors are going to be around. They're good at what they do. So take them out to lunch. Have coffee with them. Help them understand what can be done and what not. And a lot of that can be done before you even work with the company. So like what Eugene was saying, when you're interviewing, really try to understand what they're planning to do and what their expectations are and what their vision is for data science or analytics or whatever it is in their organization. And if it's something that seems
unreasonable to you, then ask. Try to understand. But take that approach where you're trying to understand, not where you're just saying, oh, that's not possible. Because, yeah, you're just going to end up with a lot of defensiveness. So it's a lot of expectation management, and I would say the higher you go in an organizational hierarchy, the more time you spend on expectation management. The more time you spend. Because those people are more detached from the realities of the day-to-day technical world inside the organization. So it's really important to have the influence where you can, because it'll make your life a lot more pleasant.
For this example, maybe I use back the example of SAP, right? How do you influence the leaders not to pick up a system that actually couldn't allow, for example, the SAP time logging and everything?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, in this context, how do you do that?
So it depends on where this comes from. So sometimes, and it's a simple case of the SAP people deal directly with the CFO, and the CFO went directly to somebody else, and then they just decided that they were going to start using SAP. Sometimes it's a compliance issue, and that's the way they chose to address the compliance issue, for example. You have fewer options in that case. But if it's a question of convincing people not to use a certain system, I typically don't take that approach. I try to understand the problem they're trying to solve. And if you start asking questions and trying to understand the problem that someone's trying to solve, sometimes they reach a point in the discussion where they themselves realize that that tool will not solve the problem. Which is ideal, because then you're not the one telling them. They figure it out for their own, on their own, by themselves, which means you don't get the defensiveness
yep.
that Ku's talking about. So one thing that I do quite a lot is I try to reframe things as questions, such that the answers help me understand more why someone reached that conclusion, which at the same time helps them realize that actually maybe it wasn't the best conclusion.
But sometimes because of ego, right, they refuse to. They know that it doesn't work, but ego, they refuse to still go ahead.
Oh, that's okay. If their ego gets in the way, that's their problem.
I mean, sometimes the budget has been set aside. They argued so much that, hey, but then it's actually a waste of money, but they haven't continued using it because the budget is.
I mean, you can't control other people's ego, right? You can only control your reaction to your own ego. So if you have your ego in check, that's basically all you can do. And there are cases, like Eugene's saying, where the budget's been approved or the project's already been going on for however long. Like the case I mentioned, where I went into a company, they had an SAP project, had been running for 5 years. They couldn't stop it because they'd capitalized all of the development costs, which meant that it technically hadn't shown up on the financials as an expense. And if they stopped the project, then millions of dollars would just hit the financials, right, like that. And this is not unusual in companies. And this is why I say, and Ku was saying earlier, when you start getting at different levels of the organization, a lot more matters than the fact that it's SAP or not SAP, right? If you have $10 million plus dollars that are going to hit your books if you stop a project, or you can finish it and never use it, and those $10 million don't hit your books all at once, does it sound stupid anymore to finish the project and never use it? Maybe. How many people are you going to have to fire if you have to write a $10 million check? It's not nice, right? So these are the kind of concerns and considerations that start coming up in an executive team, for example. But people in the development team are like, this is so stupid. We just built this and we're not even using it. There might be a good reason, like the fact that you still have a job. So it's really important to understand that kind of stuff. And sometimes you can't argue against it. Or you could, but the consequence would just be outrageous, right? I mean, personally, if you told me you have to work 9 months so that you can ship this, even though we're never going to use it, but that means everyone can keep their jobs, I'm going to do it, and I'm going to make sure it happens, and I'm going to win. And then we're all going to still have jobs, and it's going to be great. I'm not going to argue that, oh, this was a dumb project, and we had 5 years, and it's so much, and so we should stop it now. So sometimes you have to just go with it, in fact, because it's better for everybody.
Okay, that's it. Thank you. Thank you to our panelists. Cool. All right. So.
Thanks to Eugene.
Oh, thank you.
The moderator.
Yes. So we don't have to sit down now, we can stand up.